We're about ready. Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2023. And we've got a particularly busy meeting this morning as we move to item one, which is the consideration of continued petitions. And the first of those petitions is petition number 1911, the Review of Human Tissue Scotland Act 2006 as it relates to post-mortems. And this is our continued discussion and deliberation on a petition lodged by Anne Stark calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the Human Tissue Scotland Act of 2006 and the relevant guidance to ensure that all post-mortems can only be carried out with permission of the next of kin, do not routinely remove brains and offer tissues and samples to the next of kin as a matter of course. Now, this is a session we're convening this morning really on the back of the evidence that we've heard to date, and not just as a matter of routine or fancy, but because I think members of the committee have been quite drawn to the evidence that we've heard already and believe that there are issues of substance here that we might wish to pursue. And that included taking evidence recently from witnesses based in England, and where we heard about ways in which their approach to postmortems and tissue sample retention differs from ours. And they shared their experience of setting up a scanning service for postmortems, accepting that ones where the procurator fiscal is going to be involved because there are suspicious circumstances require a different route, but outlined ways in which this has reduced the requirement for full invasive postmortems. We've also heard that the next of kin are offered a range of options for how tissue samples are handled, despite our having received written evidence previously here that those issues might be insurmountable. They seem to have been dealt with in passing in England without us even questioning the witnesses. They volunteered the alternative solutions as a matter of course. And so these are things we'd quite like to pursue this morning. And we're delighted that we have with us in the gallery the petitioner. And I think it's worth just reminding everybody that this is a petition lodged by Anne Stark, whose son Richard died suddenly at the age of 25. And, you know, to all people following our proceedings, unlike many other committees of this Parliament, there is no party political manifesto agenda driving our inquiry. Our inquiry is driven because a petitioner decided to participate in the public process open to them to bring a petition to this Parliament. And all of us sitting here on this committee are really representatives of that petitioner in the way in which we seek to take forward the substance of the issue that they have raised. And I'm delighted, really delighted, to be able to welcome the Lord Advocate Dorothy Bain KC to our proceedings this morning, as well as the Head of Scottish Fatalities Investigation Unit, Andy Shanks. So thank you both very much for your time. And I understand, Lord Advocate, you would like just to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much. As Lord Advocate, I'm responsible for both the systems of criminal prosecution and investigation of deaths in Scotland. By virtue of the Scotland Act 1988, any decision in those capacities shall be taken independently of any other person. These include decisions taken on my behalf by procurator fiscals. Critical to the constitutional role that I fulfil is the ability on my part and those who act on my behalf to take any decision independent of any other person. One of the main reasons why sudden and unexpected deaths are investigated by the Procurator Fiscal is because that investigation may, depending on the circumstances, disclose a proper basis for criminal proceedings. However, the investigation is also important in ensuring that the medical cause of any death is accurately identified and recorded, that the bereaved family can be informed what led to the unexpected death of their loved one, and to identify any lessons learned to avoid similar deaths in the future. The role, yes, is one of investigating deaths, but it is also one that involves taking steps to save other lives. And I take the responsibility that I have in terms of the constitutional function that I have very seriously, and I hope to fulfil that in a humane and compassionate way.
Thank you very much, Lord Advocate. And I think in the submissions that we've received previously in writing, I think all these points are very much appreciated and understood. And I suppose, in part, what's surprised the committee is that in our investigation of practices elsewhere, there has been an evolution in the way that that function that you've just identified is fulfilled, which has proved to be, to the satisfaction of them, equally effective. And that's, I suppose, the different areas we'd like to explore this morning. But just by way of an opening question, where there are no suspicious circumstances, I mean, everybody understands that where there is any suggestion of a suspicious circumstance, that there is a completely different criminal procedure underway. But where there is no anticipated suspicious circumstance, is there scope for greater involvement, in your view, for the views of the next of kin when instructing a post-mortem?
So, whilst we appreciate that the instruction of a post-mortem is a distressing matter for the next of kin, and we will, of course, take account of their views, particularly if they're religious or cultural sensitivities, the views of the next of kin really cannot be determinative of the decision-making, that the process around this matter, because unfortunately sometimes close relatives are responsible for the fatality. We know that. And what happens in practice is that post-mortems are only instructed where it's considered essential. Post-mortem is maybe required to determine the cause of death, to ensure that the circumstances surrounding the death are fully investigated, and to exclude criminality. And the final decision is for the independent prosecutor as part of their role in investigating the person's death. And as I've said before, the independence is expressed in the Scotland Act 1998. But it is the case that postmortems are only instructed where they're essential.
And I suppose then the two questions that follow in my mind from that are, one, how is it determined that it is essential, and by what means are the views of the relatives of the deceased taken into account? What is the process by which that assessment of their preferred wishes actually is established?
So if a post-mortem is considered essential, it's in order to establish the cause of death. And in certain circumstances, it's impossible to give you all the permutations of the circumstances in which post-mortems are instructed, but it's essentially to establish the cause of death in order to inform whether there needs to be a criminal investigation or to assist in that criminal investigation, or alternatively to understand whether or not there's a systematic deficiencies in healthcare, in the way in which workplace operations are undertaken, and also where it's relevant to ascertain the cause of death in order to inform the bereaved relatives as to why it is that an individual has died. So there are a whole series of reasons, but perhaps in terms of how that's affected operationally by the Procurator Fiscal, the head of the Scottish Fatalities Investigation Unit, Mr. Shanks, can explain a little further as to how that actually happens in practice. But it is the case that it's only where it's essential, and at all times the Procurator Fiscal, along with the expert advice that's received from the pathologists, takes on board the views of the next of kin and speaks to them. Well, they discuss the issues with them, and they discuss the processes with them, and they take on board their views. Perhaps on an operational level, you could hear directly from Mr. Shanks.
Yes, good morning. During the course of that process, there is contact made with bereaved relatives throughout the course of a death investigation, and where a post-mortem examination is being contemplated, their views are sought and definitely are taken into account, particularly, as the Lord Advocate says, whether they're cultural or religious sensibilities. But really the primary purpose of the instruction of a post-mortem is for the identification of a
And is there a record of that engagement kept?
Yes, there is.
So in each case, it would be possible to demonstrate the engagement that took place with the relative in relation to the request they'd made regarding the desirability of a post-mortem?
Yes, indeed. In fact, there may well have been prior contact with the police, if it was a police-reported death, where their views may have been made clear at that stage. So even on
And is that record open to inspection?
I'm not sure by whom, convener. It's records that would be held for operational purposes by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service.
So where a relative were to assert that they didn't feel there had been any engagement, there would be a record available which would be publicly able to demonstrate that, in fact, their assertion was not correct?
I'm not sure if it would be publicly available, but certainly in response to any inquiry that was made by a member of the public, we would certainly aim to respond to that.
Thank you. The Lord Advocate there identified two situations, and I think the committee fully understands that where there is any suggestion of a suspicious death or an unknown death, that the different rules must obtain. But the Lord Advocate also suggested that there could be underlying systemic health deficiencies which post-mortem can identify. The professionals that we spoke to in England, and of course children are excluded from this because I understand scanning isn't something which works with young children because their bodies haven't developed to a point where it's appropriate, but that 94% of all causes of death are established by use of scanning and a non-invasive procedure, and I know one of my colleagues will be pursuing this later. So when you identify essential seems to me to be a very general term.
Well, it's not a decision that's taken lightly, convener. When a decision is made that a post-mortem examination must be carried out, then that instruction would be provided to the pathologist. Thereafter, generally speaking, it's a matter for his or her clinical judgment in terms of the nature and the extent of the examination that is necessary. I think the committee is also aware, having heard previous evidence, that there are certain circumstances where a non-invasive external post-mortem examination is possible, and that's very much driven by the individual circumstances. Perhaps there's a very detailed medical history that points towards a likely cause of death, and in consultation with the pathologist, the decision can be made that an external examination it may be appropriate. But even those instances, and I think we had almost 800 of those external viewing grant postmortems carried out last year, but even in those circumstances, the pathologist is still at liberty, applying his or her own professional judgment, to decide that an external examination is not sufficient in order to fully identify the cause of death, and that therefore a more invasive procedure would be required.
Can I ask, are brains always removed during a postmortem?
I'm happy to answer that, Lord Advocate. I don't think they're done as a matter of course or a routine. I think, again, it's a matter for the clinical judgment of the instructed pathologist as to the nature and the extent of the examination that's required. And again, that is dependent upon a whole manner of circumstances, convener, around the presentation of the individual and the medical records that are there.
Okay, so in terms of postmortems that are conducted, what would be the percentage of occasions in which brains were removed?
That's not something I'm in a position to answer, convener. And I would say, I mean, these are matters that are primarily for the clinical and professional judgment of the instructed pathologist. It's not something that they would be specifically directed on by the Procurator Fiscal.
I understand that, but my understanding also is that it seems to be that it is more of a matter of routine in Scotland than it is elsewhere in the United Kingdom, and that it is not the routine practice simply to remove brains in the same way that we seem to do here. And I just wonder whether, in fact, we've fallen really rather behind medical practice elsewhere in the way in which we are proceeding.
Perhaps I could come in there, convener, and just respond to what you're saying. Although the decision whether or not to instruct a post-mortem examination is for the Procurator Fiscal, the nature and extent of the examination required to determine the cause of death is for the pathologist. In all of this area of work, we are guided by the medical experts who perform the post-mortem. And the understanding that we have through our engagement is that pathologists will only retain whole organs on rare occasions when it's absolutely necessary to establish the cause of death. And in such cases, there are well-established procedures for ensuring that families are immediately advised when organ retention is a possibility and the options for return of that organ are discussed with them. For the Crown, we will use any tools available to us in our investigation to establish a cause of death and provide the next of kin with the answers where they seek answers where possible. Any decision on the appropriate course of action should be taken in consultation and discussion with the relevant pathologist and in accordance with the Royal College of Pathologists guidelines. So there are differences in process and practices and an understanding of what's required in terms of an expert being able to advise the procurator fiscal as to the cause of death between Scotland and England. It really is a matter that should be explored with the pathologists, and it's not something that we can advance really any further with you today. Unfortunately, it is a matter for the pathologists as to what they do in order to inform as to cause of death.
And to whom are they accountable?
Well, the pathologists are professional people who are medically qualified and who answer to their own professional body. We are the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal who investigate deaths and seek to identify the cause of death in order to inform whether or not we require a criminal investigation or we need to make further investigations in order to proceed with the fatal accident inquiry. Critical to all of that decision making is what caused the death, and where we require that answer, we require to instruct an expert pathologist who has responsibilities in terms of their own professional body. And if there are medical advances that could better inform pathologists operating in Scotland, then those medical advances are ones for the pathologists to advise on.
Right. Okay. Well, I'm struggling. I have to say I am struggling here because I feel I'm wrestling with a ball of cotton wool here. The pathologists themselves would have to be the ones who decided whether there were modern operational practices which would mean that there were alternative ways of fulfilling their function.
No, I understand that the pathologists that are instructed to carry out these examinations in Scotland are individuals from a professional body of the highest, that we hold in the highest regard. We, as the Crown, are informed by these experts, and we are informed as to what's required in order to establish a cause of death. If there are different practices across the profession in terms of what pathologists do, then I would assume that the professional body itself would be training, advising and giving direction to the professionals within that body. And if it is the case that there's less invasive processes that can be applied at the stage of post-mortem, then these are the ones that should be chosen by the pathologist. But really, I think it's... I can see, convener, that these are issues that are of enormous concern to you and the committee, but I think you have to distinguish between the responsibility that I have as the Lord Advocate and the responsibility that lies within the professional body of pathologists.
No, I've understood that distinction, and I'm grateful to you. You touched on the issue of retention, and the pathologists explained that small tissue samples are taken for microscopy and diagnostic purposes and are retained as part of the medical record. They say that they could theoretically be returned to relatives, but the gain would be marginal and would need traded off against further complexities in the authorisation and consent process, which are already difficult. We took evidence from Dr. Alderney and the chief coroner in England, And they said, what happens with any sample that contains even a single cell is that the family are asked what they want to be done with the sample when it is finished with. The family are given a number of choices. The coroner's office will ask whether the sample could be retained by the hospital for medical research and teaching, or it can be returned to the family and their undertaker. Indeed, they outlined a process to us whereby there can be a second funeral proceeding for the additional tissue. And all this happens regularly and as a matter of course in England. Alternatively, they can elect for the sample to be disposed of by the hospital in a lawful and sensitive manner. Those are the choices. Now, that seems to be an operational practice elsewhere in the United Kingdom, executed with no complication, no professional obstacles having been put in place, which appear to be routinely put in place by the processes that apply in Scotland. And I wonder, is that any longer appropriate, or could Scotland not now be seeking to operate in a much more transparent and frankly humane manner consistent with the practice elsewhere in the United Kingdom?
So I hear what you're saying and understand that there's a different practice in England and Wales and that you've taken evidence on that matter. As a Lord Advocate who's responsible for the investigation of criminal matters and sudden and unexpected deaths, I have a different role to play from the one this petition committee are in the process of examining. It's not for me to advise on what the law should be. I implement the law. I have to do what the law provides for in Scotland. And currently, the Human Tissue Scotland Act 2006 applies to the issues that you have raised this morning. If there's to be a change in practice, and if there's to be a more humane practice, as you've described, that's really not a matter for me this morning to comment on, Convener. I can't really advance that matter any further. All I can do is explain what the law is currently in Scotland and what the Procurator Fiscal and the Crown Office do in relation to the implementation of our investigations and what happens when the 2006 Act comes into play. So what I can say is this. At the conclusion of our investigation, by virtue of the Human Tissue Scotland Act 2006, any blocks and slides prepared for the purposes of histopathology, that's examination of the tissue under a microscope to detect any signs of disease, damage or other abnormalities, are considered to be part of the medical records of the deceased person. That's what the statutory provision provides. Now, if there's to be a change in the law, it's for parliamentarians to change the law. It's not for the Lord Advocate of the day. The decision on returning samples is for the Health Board. A requirement to offer tissues and samples to the nearest relatives as a matter of course before the end of a criminal investigation might impact on the investigation of death. It might impair the Procurator Fiscal's ability to fully investigate the circumstances surrounding the death or establish a definitive cause of death. I'm not here to advance any inhumane practice. I'm here to say how I operate within the existing law. I can only do that.
So, to which minister in the government does the responsibility fall?
The responsibility for what?
The issues that I've just discussed.
So, if the law requires changing, it's for the democratically elected representatives of people to bring forward the arguments for a change in the law. And as we know, whether law is changed, we have a process of open consultation. We have a process of parliamentary committees considering proposals for change.
And I've been here 16 years, I get that bit. But to which minister in the government would this responsibility fall?
Well, I'm not entirely sure. And I think, I don't know why you're speaking to me in the way that you are. I'm here to try and assist.
You know, I understand that. That's why I'm asking if you can assist me by telling me which minister of the government we should direct this, because you believe that's where that responsibility would lie, if not with the Crown Office.
Well, I think I've answered the question to the best of my ability,
okay.
Convener. I'm not here to be difficult, and I'm here to just explain what the job that I do as an independent head of the prosecution system responsible for the investigation of deaths in Scotland. And I operate within the law. And if there's to be a change in law, it's for parliamentarians like yourself to advance reasons for change. And I fully understand the issues that this committee are dealing with. They're very sensitive issues. They deal with issues around human dignity and the needs for bereaved relatives to be supported through what is the most traumatic period of their life, where they lose a loved one through in an unexpected circumstance.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Lord Advocate, Mr Shanks. We've heard in evidence to the committee that there is real pressures on the service due to a lack of pathologists to carry out postmortems down in England. Can the Lord Advocate or Mr Shanks confirm that the same pressures are on the pathology workforce to carry out postmortems in Scotland?
Well, I think this is a matter, an operational matter, that Mr Shanks can fully explain to you.
Yes, thank you, Lord Advocate. In response to that question, Mr Torrance, certainly in our operational experience, there is a variation in the level of service that we receive from various pathology providers across the country. There always is a degree of variation anyway in terms of the seasons of the year, as you might expect. And when I'm talking about level of service here, I'm really talking about the period of time between the instruction of a post-mortem examination and the completion of that examination. Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service are essentially service recipients here. We're not the service providers. We're not in charge of the pathologists. We rely on the service providers across the country, and we're talking here about NHS, local authorities and universities who provide that service. And we have a number of contracts and service level agreements in place with those organisations. So they are responsible for that level of service across the country. At the same time, I think we do recognise the need for an improved service more generally, and therefore we are in the process of reviewing those contracts and agreements in place to see if there's a way to make them more efficient and resilient across the board by reviewing the nature and the number of contracts that are in place. So I don't think it's for me to necessarily characterise the service in the way that you've suggested, Mr Torrance, but it's certainly it's a variable service at the moment, and there are a number of different service providers.
Thank you for that, Mr Shanks. You said that you're looking to review the system. Is the model of service that we have just now sustainable?
Well, I'm not sure that's a question I can directly answer. All I can say is that we recognise that the number of different service providers and the way that the contracts are at the moment, there is room for improvement, and that is under review with a view to making it more, as I say, more resilient and more effective across the board. But these are matters essentially for the service providers at the moment.
Just say this, that the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service is the client and the recipient of the service to allow the Lord Advocate and the Procurator Fiscals to discharge their death investigation duties. So to that end, we have a series of contracts and service level agreements with universities, local authorities and the NHS for pathology, mortuary and toxicology services across Scotland. We don't have any role in the recruitment or training of pathologists. It's a matter for the professional body. And all of what you're looking at today in terms of the way in which pathology is undertaken sits with the pathology providers. So there is a distinction between what the Crown does in this matter and what the experts who carry out these postmortems do. We are the client of the service.
Cassie, thank you for that. As a client, and you're procuring a service, can you not determine how that service looks and change, as we've just found, that the ways, the workings of the ways that they're doing in England in certain areas? Because you're procuring a service, so surely it's up to you how that service looks and is determined how it works.
I think that cuts across some of the issues that the Lord Advocate provided a response on early on in terms of the exercise of professional judgment by the individual pathologists and obviously the overarching role of the Royal College of Pathology. I think, as the Lord Advocate said, we can be supportive of tools and innovations that assist pathologists in the exercise of their professional duties, but I think that's different from being overly prescriptive about the techniques that they would deploy in particular circumstances.
You said you were in looking at a service. How far down the line are you, and how deep are you looking at a service to review and change it?
That's not something I'm personally involved in, but if the committee requires more information on that, then certainly something could be provided in writing if there are particular points around that that you would require clarification on.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. I mean, there are around 56,000 deaths in Scotland each year, and 12% of them require a post-mortem. In previous submissions to the committee, the Royal College of Pathologists stated there are significant pressures on pathology, post-mortem and forensic services across Scotland, with grossly inadequate facilities and staffing levels being the reality of the current provision. And I should earlier have recognised our colleague Monica Lennon, who's joined us this morning. She also has raised in Parliament the issues of delays and backlogs in the post-mortem service. The Lord Advocate then explained that the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service aims to conduct its investigation and advise the next of kin of the outcome within 12 weeks of the initial report of death, in at least 80% of those cases. Can I ask you, therefore, can you confirm whether those pressures on the post-mortem service exist in Scotland? And what proportion of postmortems are currently reported within 12 weeks?
That's not information I've got before me at the moment, Convener, but again, that's something I can provide in writing if it would be of assistance to the committee.
Would you expect it to achieve the objective of 12 weeks in 80% of cases, the evidence, or do you think that objective might be under challenge at the present time?
Again, that's something I'd like to follow up in writing, if that would be of convenience.
Yeah. And that was more specific, more general. I mean, are there pressures on the post-mortem service currently in Scotland?
There are variations in service, as I said before, Convener. So in particular parts of the country, and as I say, particular times of the year, it will impact on that period of time between the instruction of the examination and the completion of the examination. I'm not sure it's for me to characterise that as particular pressures, but the service is certainly variable in that regard.
And I mean, if you are able to supply us with further information, just to follow up on the point that you discussed with Mr. Torrance, it would be helpful if we could have some indication or information on the scope and the timescale of the review that was identified. I mean, earlier when I was talking to the Lord Advocate was referring to changes in the law being the responsibility of parliamentarians and not the Crown Office that is there to apply the law. But the use of imaging doesn't require any change in the law at all. There is no provision in law needs to be changed to achieve that. Alexander Stewart is going to pursue this area.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Lord Advocate, Mr. Shanks. We've already discussed and some of your questions and some of the answers have been quite vague already this morning, and I acknowledge that you are giving your views as to what role and responsibility you have. But we're trying to investigate this petition and try and ease out as much information as we can to assist the petitioner. And as the convener already says, when it comes to the potential role of imaging, there doesn't require to be a change in the law for that to take place. And we've already had information from previous witnesses when they talked about the time saving when it came to imaging. And the achievement of, as we've already heard, 94% of scans that were established the cause of death, and 92% of those postmortems were non-invasive. So it's quite obvious that the use of this equipment and the use of these scans are of real benefit to individuals, and it is of saving time and can give some reassurance to the profession and also to potentially the next of kin if that would be the case if things were progressing quicker for them. And you already have discussed this morning the targets you set and want to try and achieve within your service. So can I ask, Mr. Shanks might be the best one to answer it, acknowledging the benefits of imaging could have for both the service and for the next of kin, do you acknowledge that as a potential that you should be considering to bring forward to ensure that we have a better service for the clients and the service users and for yourselves as an individual who looks to procure that service on behalf of individuals in this case?
So I understand that the evidence that you've heard about imaging, and I understand the benefits that have been described from that process. All I can do is say this. As the Crown Office and Prosecutor Fiscal Service investigating the cause of death, we instruct experts to undertake the examination. And we are informed by the expert as to whether or not an invasive post-mortem is required. If there is a process of imaging that means there's no need for an invasive post-mortem, then I would expect that the pathologist of the day would advise that that is available rather than having an invasive post-mortem. But the quality of the imaging, the efficacy of the imaging, the benefits of the imaging are really for the professional body to consider and to determine whether or not they should be utilised in the process that they're undertaking. So if the Royal College of Pathologists have identified a means by which you can have less invasive postmortems and you can undertake that by imaging, one would reasonably expect, as Lord Advocate, who's instructing the investigation of a death and to understand the cause of death, that the pathologist advising the Crown on that issue would explain that this process is available and should be used. And whether or not there's a provision of imaging in Scotland to the same extent as that in England, I'm not aware, because it is a matter for the professional body of pathologists to advise on. I haven't heard all of the evidence that you have heard on as to how the pathologists undergo their examinations in England and Wales, but one would expect there should be a consistent approach in relation to the decision as to whether or not to conduct an invasive or non-invasive examination.
Thank you for that, Lord Advocate, and I acknowledge that, but it would appear that there seem to be barriers at the moment in Scotland. And that seems to be one of the areas where we do have some concern that, as a matter of course, in other parts of the United Kingdom, facilities are available and imaging takes place. And that is not happening here. And the question is why? And you've explained that the professional organisation has a role to play in all of that. But it's quite difficult for individuals and the petitioner themselves to see why there seems to be that differentiation between what takes place here. But it would have to be then, my understanding would say, there would be a barrier happening in Scotland that is not permitting this to then take place. And do you acknowledge that may well be a case, that there's a barrier within the service that's not providing something to the same standard in Scotland that it is in other parts of the United Kingdom?
So could you explain to me what you mean by the barrier?
Well, I would...
What has been the identified barrier in Scotland?
It could be many things. It could be a lack of training. It could be a lack of equipment. It could be, I don't know. I mean, I'm making an assumption here that there's a barrier, because I'm not, from what you've said this morning, I'm not convinced that Scotland shouldn't be doing this. And you've given information and given evidence to suggest that it would be up to the professionals. Well, the professionals, in my opinion, are not doing it because there's a problem. And if there's a problem, it may be that a barrier is in place or there's a something that's a logjam or something that's causing the situation to occur. And that would be my interpretation of it. But it would be good to get your view if you think that is a similar issue.
I don't. So it's difficult for me to answer the question you pose when you've not actually identified a single barrier. But what I would say is this, that I think that your questions and your anxiety over this issue and your concern, which is very obvious, should be directed to the professional body who deliver the service to the Crown, the professional body of the Royal College of Pathologists who operate in Scotland, who carry out these post-mortem examinations at our request. It is simply the case that the Crown would only ever instruct a post-mortem, and the post-mortem that would be instructed would be one that would be then informed by what the pathologists are telling us needs to be done in order to identify the cause of death. Now, if there's a less invasive process and one that's available in England and Wales, I would expect that the pathologists in Scotland should know about that and should have access to the same facilities and the same provision. And if they don't have, and if their job is not, if they're not being able to do their job in the way that they should be, then they should be raising that with their professional body. And they should be letting those within their professional body know, and they should be taking steps to ensure that the equipment that's required in order for them to carry out their job is available. Now, there's only so much that the Lord Advocate can do. I cannot instruct the Royal College of Pathologists to take the steps that you've identified might be needed in order to resolve the issue that you're so concerned about.
And you acknowledge that that is a role that we have here to ensure if Parliament wants to change things and wants to make things happen, that it's up to individuals like Monica Lennon, MSP, who's put forward and supported this petition to try and bring it, and we're doing that exactly now by having this discussion, by having this debate about the topic. We are putting the topic further up the agenda to try and ascertain what the problem might be and what the solutions should be. I see that is my role within this committee to try and tease out some of that evidence and to try and tease out some of the issues that are there so that we can provide the best service we can within our capability for individuals within Scotland. But as I say, I am perplexed when they are not being the similar quality is being given to people who are south of the border. And that, to me, is not right in some respects. The individuals who are in Scotland are not being provided with the same standard of information and the same standard of operation that is taking place elsewhere. And as I say, that is perplexing me as a member of this committee. And I'm trying to tease out the issues that will maybe try and iron out that and support people to get a better service.
Well, I understand what you've said, and it is the case that the law is changed by people bringing forward problems, bringing forward injustices, identifying inhumane, improper practices, and bringing it to the attention of the parliamentarians. And it's for the parliamentarians to change the law. And I can't do that. And if there's to be a change in service and better service, well, I would support that. But I can't do that. I have a particular role to perform here in terms of my constitutional responsibility, and I can only do that. Indeed, if I were to come forward and suggest changes in policy, practice and the law, it would be quite inconsistent with the job that I have, which is to uphold the law as it is. If there's to be a change, it's for people like yourself, committed to issues like these, to make the change. And I don't dispute any of what you've said here today.
Thank you, Convener.
I do return to the fact that the use of imaging doesn't require a change in the law. There was no change of the law in England when the practice was changed. It was just changed. It didn't require parliamentarians to change the law. It required direction and discussion.
Turn to that point. My point is, if there's to be a different process applied by the expert pathologist, that's for the expert to apply. If pathologists in Scotland don't have access to imaging of the type, that's not for me to change, and it's not requiring a change in law. It's a change in professional practice and the availability of the essential tools for that. It's not my responsibility.
I
understand. The thing is, of course, it's not pathologists, it would be radiologists, and it may very well be that the reason pathologists aren't interested in pursuing this is because it's not a service that they would be able to provide.
That
I do think ought to be a matter of public concern and further. Now, both Mr Chowdhury and Mr Ewing want to go in. Is it to develop this point or to touch on a different point?
I think it's to develop.
This point. But Mr Chowdhury, then Mr Ewing.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning. Sorry, I'm just confused, and of course I don't want to repeat what my colleagues has already asked. My question to yourself would be, I get what the point you're saying, that it's up to us to make the policies, and you won't be able to answer quite a lot of questions, but my question to yourself would be, how are the samples examined just now, and what we are hearing, and what I've read, that we are not same as what's happening in England and Wales? If not, why and who should be telling us that we're not same and we're not doing the same job as they're doing in England and Wales? And what's the procedure now? And what procedures are we following?
Yes, I mean, like the Lord Advocate said, I mean, I can't speak to the particular practices and procedures that are taking place elsewhere in the UK, but certainly in Scotland, the conduct of the post-mortem examinations is a matter for the professional clinical judgment of the pathologist on the instruction that a post-mortem has to take place from the procurator fiscal. I think I'd be repeating my earlier points if I was to go any further there.
Mr Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Lord Advocate. I absolutely understand the central point that you're making, that the concerns that other colleagues have expressed this morning are not matters for which you, as Lord Advocate, have legal responsibility. So I understand that. I mean, we are here because the petitioner's not only lost a child, but that horrific experience for any parent was compounded, as Monica Lennon has eloquently said on previous occasions, by what happened afterwards. And therefore, my question to you is this, and it's really about the role of Lord Advocate in Scotland. After all, you are leading the system of criminal prosecutions and the investigations of death. And is there not an argument, a stateable argument, that whilst there are certain specific legal responsibilities that you've clearly set out and are clearly delineated, and we understand, that there is perhaps a higher obligation that, you know, if not the Lord Advocate, then who? I mean, who can deal with this? The professional bodies, it seemed to me, are patently not really going to be able to do this. Would it not be the case that some people, Lord Advocate, may see your role not so much as being that of an umpire or referee, but that of a team manager, where if something really goes wrong, then some kind of action would be expected of the Lord Advocate in order to initiate action, if not by yourself because you lack the legal power and competence to do so, nonetheless by urging others to do so, whether that be the Scottish Government, the Royal Colleges or otherwise, and where you, for example, following this petition, and our job is to speak for the petitioner, that's why we are here, it's nothing to do with politics at all or whatever, as the Convener said, is there not a stateable argument that some people, Lord Advocate, see your role in a much wider sense than you appear to have set out to us today? And if there is merit in that, is there something which is worth reflecting upon as to whether there's any way in which your esteemed office, your distinguished office, such an important office for the dispatch of justice in Scotland, could take action to deal with the horrendous grievance suffered by the petitioner in this case?
Well, I wonder what you suggest should be done.
Well, I've
by the Lord
already.
Advocate.
Sorry.
I wonder what you suggest should be done, because you know very well the role of the Lord Advocate in Scotland. What are you suggesting?
Well, I think it's perhaps for the committee to consider this later, but my first reaction is that we could recommend that you make specific series of recommendations as Lord Advocate as to how the injustice suffered by these parents can be remedied. It's not a straightforward matter, I admit, but then very few things are in government, I've discovered. But nonetheless, it is an important one, and just because something is difficult doesn't mean that governments can fail to discharge their functions.
So if this committee recommend a series of actions that would alleviate an injustice suffered, and that comes within the responsibility of the Lord Advocate of the day, of course I'll act. And I wouldn't say anything other than that. So I'd be very interested in the recommendations made by this committee. I'm only interested in providing a humane and progressive criminal justice system that meets the needs of everybody. And yes, it is often the case that I deal with difficult issues, but I think for there to be some sort of underlying suggestion that I would ignore the decision of this committee or the recommendations of this committee, that I wouldn't act to make better things that have gone badly, is quite unfair. I am here today to give evidence, to answer questions, and of course, if there are recommendations made that I can do something about, I will do it.
Thank you very much, Lord Advocate. That final remark is very helpful. And if we've seemed a bit testy, it's partly not just to benefit from that assurance. It's also, I think, for this committee, the confusion that we have as to where best we need to pursue these points. And I think probably colleagues will consider who else we may need to see in order to try and bring that position around. But we look forward to receiving the additional written information that's been received. But thank you both very much. And I'll invite Monica Lennon now just to say a few words as one who's been actively engaged with us on this petition. Monica Lennon.
Very grateful, Convener, and to the committee and indeed to the Lord Advocate and Mr Shanks. Again, thank you for taking this petition very seriously and getting to this point today. We have heard a lot of evidence over many months now, and as you said, Convener, at the start, real issues of substance. The session that we had most recently with the coroner and the pathology team and radiology team was really important, and I think it helped to set out in our minds that there is different practice that is emerging, that has been in place now for a few years, that does, you know, continue to provide an effective and accurate service and system, but with families and people at the heart of that. So very heartened to hear from the Lord Advocate her commitment to humane and progressive practice. And I think we all want to, you know, hear what recommendations come from this committee, because you're right, Convener, operationally in terms of policy and practice, there are changes that could be made. I think there is a bit of corralling people to get that dialogue and that direction. Lord Advocate is correct that the role of the Royal Colleges is very important, but the Royal College of Pathologists are one stakeholder and one partner in this. And, you know, they might want to protect certain things the way things are done right now, but we heard that, you know, really the reason for the change in Lancashire, which is about 150 miles from where the Stark family live in Lanarkshire in my region, is because of that shortage of pathologists and those electing to become pathologists but not wanting to do postmortems because there's other important work that they do. So we've heard about the opportunities to speed things up, to alleviate workforce pressures, and what's happened in England, because we do need to get the correct equipment for this, but that's proven to be cost neutral, which is very important for those of us who, yes, are parliamentarians thinking about the law, but also thinking about public finance. So I really do appreciate the fact that the committee's been able to hear directly from the Lord Advocate today, but, you know, this is an issue that really needs to go to the top of the agenda. And of course, I'm sure that ministers in health and in justice will be very interested. We haven't heard from them. I know that Mrs. Stark has been busy engaging with MSPs and had a number of meetings since we last met. So I'm quite encouraged that colleagues from across the parliament, irrespective of party politics, can understand the very human issues at the heart of this. No one's looking for shortcuts or to undermine the very important role that the Lord Advocate has set out in terms of the duties that she and her team have to undertake. But I would again just thank the committee for your time. I think it is important that we bear in mind, you know, what can change now and with very little resource, and where we might need to have that change in the law, particularly around some of these issues about tissue samples and retention. As you know, the petitioner set out a number of proposals, and I know you're looking at that very carefully. But what's encouraging to me is not just practice emerging in other parts of the United Kingdom, it's also what's happening internationally. And I think the committee is aware of practice that's emerged in Japan, also in Australia, where there's now a faculty of post-mortem imaging. So it seems to me that to have that humane and progressive system that we all want to have, then we maybe need to be a bit more proactive in making sure that we keep pace. And I'm sure there's things that we're doing in Scotland that are cutting edge and innovative and people can learn from us, but we need to look outwards. And I thank the committee for your efforts to do that.
Thank you very much, Monica Lennon. And can I thank the forbearance of the petitioner, who we remember is with us in the gallery this morning. It was the loss of her son which led to this petition being discussed before Parliament. And we thank her again for that. And Lord Advocate and Mr Shanks, thank you both very much. I mean, that actually has been very helpful to us, and we look forward to receiving the further information. Very grateful for your time this morning. Thank you very much. And I'll now have a short suspension before our next inquiry. And welcome back to our 10th meeting of the Citizens Engagement and Public Participation Committee this morning. Our next petition under item 1, continuing petitions, is petition number 1992 to dual the A9 and improve road safety. And I'm delighted to say that we are joined by the petitioner herself, Laura Hansler, who joins us this morning. A very warm welcome to the committee. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to deliver on the commitment it made in 2011 and address safety concerns on the A9 by publishing a revised timetable and detailed plan for dualling each section, completing the dualling work by 2025 and creating a memorial to those who've lost their lives in a road traffic incident on the A9. As I mentioned a moment ago, we are joined by the petitioner Laura Hansler and also by Graham Barn from the Civil Engineering Contractors Association Scotland. So a very warm welcome to you as well, Mr. Barn. We're also joined this morning by a number of MSP colleagues who are here already or will be joining us. Firstly, we have Edward Mountain, who joins us as a reporter for the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee on this petition. And Mr. Mountain will be considering us, assisting us in our consideration of the petition, including during today's evidence sessions. Good welcome to you, Edward. Nice to have you with us. We also have with us Murdo Fraser. We have Kate Forbes, who I understand may be following proceedings online at present, but will be joining in the proceedings later on. And we also have Mark Ruskell, MSP, joining us as well. And we have apologies from Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, who had hoped to join us. And all of them will have an opportunity to contribute at the end of the second evidence panel. And in addition to that, we've received a written submission from Rhoda Grant, who's unable to join us this morning due to other committee business. So a positive galaxy of parliamentary investigative talent will be brought to bear as we pursue the inquiry. And after, of course, we've heard from our two witnesses, we'll be suspending for a brief time and then hearing from Transport Scotland. Now, I understand in the first instance that the petitioner would like to make a short statement, and I'm very happy to invite you so to do.
Thank you very much, Convener. First of all, I want to thank you for allowing me to bring this petition to you. I first became involved with this campaign as a direct result of listening to families' first-hand accounts of losing their loved ones as a consequence to RTCs on the A9. The history to dual the A9 dates back to the 1970s when the initial old road was rerouted from our small Highland villages, bypassing them. Such was the dramatic rise in traffic and a need for improved road safety, a direct comparison that we can note today. But why dualling? Dualling by virtue removes the proclivity for a head-on collisions to almost 100% where there is a fixed central reservation in place. Head-on collisions are normally the most horrific accidents involving multiple vehicles and producing the most fatalities. In 2022, 12 out of 13 fatalities were a direct result of multi-vehicle RTC on single carriageway sections. Only one fatality was on a dual section and involved no other vehicle. In just 3 months, 9 innocent people lost their lives on the A9 within a distance of 28 miles, all on single carriageway sections. 5 of these within metres of each other at Slocht within a matter of weeks, and these included 2 grandparents and their 2-year-old grandson. However, it is in most recent times, specifically the SNP's 2007 manifesto, that dualling becomes more pressing. The Scottish Government then outlined ambition plans to dual the A9 in 2009 with a £3 billion project. In 2011, this became a pledge of the utmost priority to complete the dualling in the totality Perth to Inverness by 2025. Such was the exponential rates of deaths by RTC on the A9 then. Today, we have no clear indications as to when the 9 out of the 11 initial sections might even be dualled. Only 11 miles out of a promised 80 are dualled to date. With no clear guidance from the recent briefings in chambers from the then Transport Minister, Jenny Gilruth, who insisted she would make a revised timetable after consultations with Transport Scotland. This was to be available by October 2023. And to date, we have been given no clear indications after numerous changes within the government as to when or indeed whom will make a concerted effort to refocus on the dualling of the A9. Many of us fully expect this to include a retraction of plans, partially and fully, or in fully, of any more drilling the remaining sections. As has been discussed in the media by myself and civil engineers, each section, it takes at least 1 year for procurement and 2 years of constructions. Now, bearing in mind we have 9 sections yet to drilled, it's pretty simple maths. 27 years onto 2023 brings us to 2050, which is an utterly shambolic state of affairs. But these figures are conservative. So far, no 2 sections have been drilled consecutively nor sequentially. There have been so far very significant delays between sections. This is an unattainable situation, with no real explanation or forthcoming apology either from the Transport Minister or the Scottish Government. However, there have been various pockets of monies, but I do say that these are just an elastoplast on an already hemorrhaging wound. And where has the £3 billion budget gone? Where has our money gone? Colette Stevenson, SNP MSP, clearly stated within chambers in a response to a motion read by Graeme Simpson on February 22nd that a significant portion of this money had actually been siphoned off to the beleaguered Edinburgh Trams project. Furthermore, in figures obtained by ourselves under the Freedom of Information, an accident in 2017 would cost £2,158,284 per fatality. If we calculate the current fatalities from 2011 till the end of 2022 at 59, it brings us to a horrific figure of £127,338,756. And please remember, this is an underestimate of figures. We should never put a cost on anyone's life. However, this appears exactly what the Scottish Government are doing, because innocent people are playing with their lives day in and day out on the A9. The A9 itself is a long, laborious drive which brings throughout the year very changeable and exceptional variable weather conditions. The ambiguity of dual to single carriageway, poor signage, unlit junctions, lack of adequate white lines, cat's eyes that no longer reflect, snow poles or no snow poles. Every few hundred yards you swap between a newly resurfaced section of road that therefore is completely up to date with safety legislation, straight back onto a section so poorly maintained it compounds the ambivalence of the A9, giving the A9 the infamous title of Scotland's killer road. The A9 is a main arterial road throughout Scotland, often referred to as Scotland's spine, and yet it appears to be getting treated like a country back road, when nearly 33,500 vehicles use it each and every day. From local commuting, HGVs bringing essential supplies, and our emergency services keeping our rural communities safe. It is a direct link to our islands, Skye, Lewis and Harris, Orkney and beyond. Inverness now is one of the fastest growing cities in Europe, and we have a great deal of investment going into the Freeport and Invergordon. And it is, of course, an essential tourist route in bringing much needed revenue to the Highlands and Islands. Monies were ploughed into the NC500, but how utterly ironic is it that we have no safe road with which to get them there? I have requested for an investigation into the procurement procedure. Why are major road projects within Scotland so highly unattractive to the construction industry? But many answers lay directly with the Scottish Government, who, unlike actually our English counterparts, find it acceptable for the risk of burden to be 100% to the construction industry, and each tender bid cost a company in excess of £500,000 to lodge, making major roads projects within Scotland a highly risky and unlucrative proposition. Recently, and in the news numerous times, has been the failure to secure the contract in the Tamat and Tamoy section, with only one contractor submitting a bid. This bid was subsequently rejected on the grounds that it failed to deliver value for money. This section is currently up for re-tendering, with absolutely no guarantees it will attract further interest. It is only within these last 2 weeks that the A9 claimed yet another innocent life, this time of an 18-year-old man on this very section of the A9 at the Tamat and Tamoy at Dalmagarry Quarry. One can't help but thinking that had Transport Minister and Transport Scotland got on with their jobs, and maybe, yet again, we wouldn't be in this situation. A family wouldn't be burying their son and a community wouldn't be without its loved ones. We have asked under a Freedom of Information without success to obtain the statistics for a life-changing injury and disabilities as a direct result of RTC on the A9. Short term, there is a loss of earnings, longer term, the loss of your career and the subsequent pressure to secure suitable benefit support. the loss of the home through lack of earnings or a house that subsequently becomes unsuitable and unsafe with those for life-changing injuries. Within our emergency service, there is a sharp rise of noted PTSD as a direct result of attending accidents on the A9 being seen throughout our mental health services. And for the loved ones left behind, unable to process this unfathomable burden of grief, there's been suicide. We simply cannot allow this wholly unacceptable state of affairs to continue. Yes, it is a betrayal of the Highlands, but mostly it's a complete and utter disregard and disrespect to those who have lost their lives and the loved ones left behind. A total of 335 people have now lost their lives in 252 collisions on the Perth to Inverness section of the A9 since 1979, when the old road was bypassed. These people are not statistics that I will allow to be hidden in a drawer to make these situations more palatable. And that is why I'm calling for a national memoriam. Not only should every name be etched in the memory of every minister ever involved with dueling the A9, it is, by a small measure, a means of an apology to our families and our communities. And unfortunately, it is a very sad indictment. I sit here with a very heavy heart today at the beginning of our summer holidays, knowing that many more lives are going to be lost in the A9 over the coming months, innocent lives going about their daily business. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll ask an introductory question both, and then I'll invite colleagues to come in. And I know we may come back to touch on the memorial, which you referred to just at the end there, but how would you... I mean, has this impacted personally on you, the delay that has taken place? And what is your view of the kind of interaction Transport Scotland has had with communities and the way that's evolved during this process?
I mean, I think, obviously, where I particularly live, I was one of the first sections to be jailed. I don't actually even use the jail section. I can go back to the initial roadshows that were done back in 2009, and they were very promising, very interactive, etc., etc. Since then, I think there's been a lack of direct communication with communities. A lot of people don't know what's happening. Certainly when there's accidents in the A9 now, I mean, you know, certainly between the Easter school summer holidays and the October school holidays, you try to avoid it as much as you can, but certainly in our small villages, you can no longer avoid the A9. It is part of your daily commute, and people really don't want to use it unless they really, really have to in peak seasons.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Barn, good morning and welcome to you. Just an introductory question to you. 1993 was, we had George Bush Sr., we had Boris Yeltsin, we had John Major. Jurassic Park was the top movie that year. Your submission yesterday rather suggests that dinosaurs still rule the earth in Transport Scotland when it comes to the way in which contracts are awarded. And that seems to be a central point of the case that you're making, that the process that is in place is one which is not going to encourage interest.
Thank you very much, Convener, for that. There's two strands to what my submission was around. It was around how do we duel the A9 and what kind of timescales that could possibly be and what the options are. And secondly, there are a couple of hurdles that we have to overcome, and one being the bespoke standard contract that Transport Scotland use, which is highly unattractive to the contracting industry. And the reason for that is that...
Just to be clear to the reference in 1993, that's when the rest of the country moved away from using that form of contract.
That's the date when a new contract came in, the NEC, the new engineering contract. So that's when it was introduced, and over that period of time, it has become the industry standard from there on in. The standard Transport Scotland contract is unattractive to contractors, is that all the financial risk lies with the contractor. And all those risks are things such as, but not only these, ground conditions, weather, utilities, and third-party consultations, which can all take up time. And when you're on a fixed-priced contract where there are time penalties at the end of it, then that risk is all lying with the contractor. It's our contention that if you can use these other contracts, they're much fairer, and there's a more equitable share of risk between client and contractor. And what you then find is you have a better working relationship between client and contractor on these projects. And you must bear in mind that almost every major road project in recent years, the principal contractors have all lost money, significant sums of money. So they're not too keen to continue with that process. And so the way to allow contractors to come back into the game again is to change the contract to one that's more fairer and more attractive to the contracting industry.
OK, thank you. Now, colleagues have an indication of who might... Mr Ewing.
Yes, thank you, and thank you very much to the petitioner convener for setting out so comprehensively the sad series of unacceptable facts on this issue. And I'm not going to repeat what petitioner said, but I think she has done a service for the people of the Highlands. I wanted to focus on how we move forward and get duelling done as swiftly as possible. And I wanted to ask Mr Barn two areas and two aspects. Firstly, the re-tendering of Tamat and Moy. And secondly, what he, as the representative of, I think, 80% of the civil engineering sector in Scotland, which is the vast majority of businesses that are involved in doing the work, what you think should be the solution, what needs to change. So if you just take Tamat and Moy first, there was only one bidder, and that bid was rejected because it wasn't said to offer value for money. That appears to mean the offer was too high. Is that your understanding? And given that contract is being re-tendered, and Transport Scotland, in a very late submission to us, submitted this morning, I think, or maybe late yesterday, they have said that they have had engagement with yourself, Mr Barn, and others in the industry about changing the risk profile in Tamat and Moy. Have they done that? And is there a risk that actually, when the contract Tamat and Moy is re-tendered, which is supposed to be done by the end of this year, that we might end up with an even higher price than the one which was rejected because it was deemed to be too high?
Thanks, Mr. Ewing, for that question. The situation with Tamat and Moy is, you're absolutely correct, there was only one bidder for that, and that bid was rejected on price, I believe. I'm not sure what the final price, the bid price was, because that's commercial, so I don't know what that was. But there was only one bidder, so there was actually no competition for that particular section. Transport Scotland have had consultation with us, and we have been working with them on how we can make these sections and all road projects in Scotland more attractive. I think the issue that we still have is that they are just trying to move their existing contract and tweak the existing contract by changing the risk profile of the existing contract they have, rather than moving to the industry standard contract. So that's where we are with it. And it remains to be seen just how many contractors will come in and bid for the Tamat and Moy section when it comes back out to tender again. We haven't seen the tender documents yet, so we don't know what the... Well, I don't know what the contract might look like at this stage. There may be competition that may be attractive to bring one or two more into it. I can't say for absolute certain. What I'm fairly certain about, though, is the price will probably have gone up. We have gone 6 months, and construction inflation is running between 10 and 15%. So it is likely that it will be more expensive than probably what was bid the first time round.
So it could be even higher than the price, which was deemed to be too high?
It could be, yeah.
Yeah. The profit margin in these contracts is 2%, is that standard?
That's the standard profit margin for civil engineering contractors across all work that we do. So it doesn't take much to go wrong with a job. for it to go seriously wrong, and especially on a job where all the risk lies with the contractor, and that's what makes them unattractive.
I think the figure that was provided in the tender for Tomaten Moy is the estimated value of the contract was, from memory, £115 million. Can you explain, from your industry knowledge, whether that represents a very detailed estimate after ground investigations have been done? In other words, how robust is that figure as an accurate indication or estimate of the likely a cost of the project?
I'm not sure just how up-to-date that pricing was, and that perhaps is a question for the colleagues in Transport Scotland behind here to answer that question. It doesn't seem to me, from what I've heard within the industry, that it was a very accurate costing that had been done. Whether that's been... it's not accurate because it's a good few years out of date, I don't know, but that's the feedback I've had from within the industry. It wasn't very accurate pricing in the first place.
Mm. So the point I'm making is that it's perhaps wrong to postulate that £150 million actually was really a proper estimate at all. It was more or less a sort of stab in the dark. So we don't actually know if that figure was a valid basis as considering it as a yardstick of value. Is that a fair comment?
Yeah, and there is recent history where Transport Scotland have actually awarded with just one bidder. Anyway, so they awarded the Hodigan roundabout job with just one bidder.
So there's a precedent there. Could I just ask about the way in which the Transport Scotland conduct the tender process? My understanding is that once the process gets going, they cease contact with the tendering companies. And therefore, if, for example, as I discovered in the course of the timescale of that tender, I discovered that some supply companies in the quarrying sector had not been approached for estimates, then that would... I found information which indicated to me that it was unlikely that a particular company was going to submit a bid because it hadn't bothered to get estimates from the company from whom it normally gets estimates. Transport Scotland, as I understand it, and tell me if this is correct, don't actually engage with the various contractors that are on the approved list to bid, and therefore perhaps... They weren't really aware until far later than they might have done had they had pursued a more collaborative approach that they might end up with only one bidder.
Our clients have to be mindful of procurement law and to be seen to be fair to all tenderers in that. But most clients have some sort of local knowledge and to find out what's actually going on around their particular project. It is surprising that they weren't aware that there was only truly one bidder in for this particular project.
Just if I might move on to the second area, Convener, which was Mr. Barnes' view about how this can best be sorted.
I will invite Mr. Fraser to address the committee later, but he has got a supplementary he'd like to ask on the Tomaten Moy particular issue. Mr. Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. I'm particularly obliged for you letting me in, not being a member of this committee at this stage. But there's one particular point I'd like to put to Mr. Byrne on this point. And the petitioner made, I thought, a very powerful comment earlier about the Tomaten Moy section and the tragic death of that young man from Moray who lost his life at Dalmagarry, I think, just 2 weeks ago. And we can only speculate what might have happened had progress been made on duelling that section. Instead of it being a single carriageway. But I just noticed that there'd been a government-initiated question lodged on Monday afternoon in the name of Jim Fairley, asking the Scottish Government when the new procurement for duelling of the A9 between Tomaten and Moy will commence. Now, as you know, Convener, a government-initiated question is when the government wants to make an announcement to Parliament and they ask a backbencher to lodge a question that enables that to be done. But curiously, this question was not answered on Monday and has now been withdrawn, which suggests that there may be an announcement imminent, but for some reason was not ready to be made. So it's a very curious issue. Perhaps we can explore further with Transport Scotland when they appear at the committee. But I just wanted to ask Mr. Barnes, as he's here, if he's aware of any moves by government then to... advance the bidding process on this particular section, given something appears to be happening in the background.
No, all I'm aware of is that we're working to the timetable that was announced by the Minister, which was there would be an award in autumn of this year, the back end of this year. That does mean that the procurement process by which we go through is normally a year, is going to have to be shortened, but Transport Scotland, they advised me that that was doable still within the time frame. So that's the only information I have. Sorry.
And just one follow-up to that. If the intention was to award the contract by the end of this year, what is the reasonable last date at which a contract could be put out to bid?
Well, it depends on what information they're asking back from the contractor, but 6 months is going to be pushing it. But, you know,
we're very tight for it.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. Well, I did note that there is a mysterious statement to be made in the final half hour before we rise for the summer recess, the content of which we know not at this time. So perhaps we can all live in hope. And I'll return to Mr. Ewing.
Thank you, Convener. In the statement that you provided to this committee, which is extremely helpful and succinct, you've set out the ways in which you, as the voice of industry, believe that procurement can be changed in order to achieve the objective which the petitioner set out, namely the swiftest possible completion of the A9 project, to which the First Minister yesterday, I believe, said the commitment is cast iron. I think that was the phrase he used. So that's welcome. But how do we get that done? Because the petitioner has already said that current rate of progress, we wouldn't see the job done until 2050, which I'll be keep pushing up the daisies, I think, by then. But seriously, the issue I think before us is how can we make the necessary changes in order to get the job done as swiftly as possible? I think there are two or three options, and I wonder if it might be helpful, Convener, if Mr. Barn can set those out in his own words for us today.
Okay. I've given some examples of ways through procurement that it can be done. And these are only some examples. There are other multiple ways in which you can do it. But if we start in no particular order, I favour none of these particular areas because they all have pros and cons to them. But if you're looking to get it done the quickest way, then it would be done in two or three sections, all done at one time. That would be the quickest way of getting it done. It would be absolutely terrible to drive between Perth and Inverness. Inverness might be cut off for a while while they're doing it, but that would be the quickest way of doing it. How you fund that would be the other challenge around this, because that could be £4 billion worth of work to be done to actually dual that section, the remaining sections. So the other option would be a PFI approach to that, and that is for the governments to decide how they wish to fund it. So all of these measures depend on the funding that's available to do it. So if you want to do all in one go, you have to use a whole pile of your capital budget to be able to do it, or you do it through the public sector with a PFI. There are some concerns. I think the PFI approach, from a contractor's perspective, a UK contractor's perspective, if you use the same contract, they're unlikely to be interested in that at all. And you may then have to go to a European contractor who would come in. You then have the problem of the European contractor not having a supply chain, and so they would have to use the existing Scottish supply chain for that. There's a number of issues around PFI. Why the UK contractors are not interested in it is because they get a double whammy if they're using the old contract, where they get penalised by the client for being late because of risk being causing a project to be late, but also they get penalised by the finance company for being late as well, because they're not getting interest from the client because the client is not ready to pay because the road's not ready. So on the Aberdeen Western Peripheral, the amount of charges the contractor was paying was £100,000 per day for it. So you can understand why contractors are not particularly interested in proceeding with those types of risks based on the contract that was used at that time. So then moving forward to other options, you could have a framework idea where you have a framework that could be a 10-year framework where you put all the contractors, the bids get into this framework, and then you allocate work to these contractors to do the sections as and when you have the money to do them. That costs money for a contractor to go into a framework could be £400,000 to £500,000 to get on that type of framework to bid for it. So they won't spend that money if they're actually thinking there's actually a real possibility of work coming through that framework for us. So again, there has to be cast iron guarantees that there is the funding available to actually complete the dualling for it, or else contractors will go, there's work elsewhere. Why would we spend that money without a guarantee of some sort of work coming through the framework? And the other option is, again, which will take the longest time to do this, but you could probably fund it the easiest way this way, as you break down these sections into even smaller areas, smaller sections, and you just do it as and when you can afford to pay for it. It will take longer. This way it would support the Indigenous Scottish contracting industry. You would retain a road building capability within Scotland, but it would take a very long period of time for the road to be dualled in that way. So those are just some of the possibilities that you could do.
A framework contract could involve 5 or 6 or several companies, perhaps mostly in Scotland, sharing work involved in completing the A9. And it would be possible to put, for example, the section of the A96 from Smithton to Aldern, which is also a government commitment, not affected by the Bute House Agreement, into that. And that might have the benefit, Mr. Barn, of limiting the disruption or spreading it out across the road network rather than, you know, risking the closure of the A9 to Inverness, which is not an attractive prospect to many of my constituents, I suspect. So that would be possible. It could be put into the framework contract.
That's all possible. How you bundle that all together is really down to the client, essentially.
And from the point of view of the companies in the framework contract, they would have guaranteed work, really, for that period of 10 years. So they would then be able more easily to recruit and retain staff, have a long-term relationship with suppliers, perhaps getting more keen prices for quarrying and other material, and they would have a guaranteed order book, so it would instill confidence and retain employment in Scotland at a time when I understand that in the UK there are many other opportunities for civil engineers to do work down south, for example.
Yes, absolutely correct.
All these benefits would accrue. So just one, I appreciate your time, Convener. I've just got one further question I'd like to ask.
There are a queue behind you, Mr. Ewing, but please.
Well, I'm sure that they'll wait with due patience, but there was just...
I'm sure they will.
Yeah, well, they haven't really much choice. But seriously, there's just one further question I wanted to ask, which is this, that there are, as the petitioner rightly said, 9 sections out of the 11 which haven't been done. Now, only one of those hasn't had a design sorted out. That's the Dunkeld section, essentially. 3 have had ministerial approval, but 4 have gone to what's called made orders. Now, that means they've gone through the legal process. 2 of those 4, the legal process was completed well over a year ago, I think coming up for 2 years ago. I mean, am I right in saying that actually there was absolutely nothing apart from an unwillingness to devote sufficient funding? There was nothing to have prevented the Scottish Government from progressing those 4 sections immediately after completion of the made orders, had there been a necessary will to implement the promised dual the A9. Is that an oversimplification, or is that a fair comment given your knowledge of the practicalities about how these things work? Because the made order means you've sorted out compulsory purchase, you've sorted out ancillary roads orders, you've gone through the process of consultation, you've got your design route, everything has been sorted out, and it's ready to go, it's ready to roll, shovel ready is the phrase. Is that basically a correct explanation, or is it oversimplified?
That would be a fair view, in my opinion.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Torrance, then Ms. Mr Mount, and then Mr Stewart, David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Just to put on record, as somebody who knows the A9 well and has been to the Moy Fair for the last 25 years, this Fergus will probably testify, he's seen me there. Your first option there, which was the quickest way to do it, to break it down into three sections, how much would that disrupt the tourist industry and cut it off for a long, long time in the area?
It would be a disruptive way to do the road, absolutely would be. You've got three sections there, so trying to manage three traffic management systems across a huge length of the A9 would be, well, it would be very difficult for everyone, to be honest with you, yes.
Just getting record, these communities around there, like Aviemore, places like that, and a lot of your holiday towns, would be absolutely devastated, wouldn't they?
It would be for a period of time, and it could be 4 or 5 years, perhaps longer in terms of construction, yeah.
With that, the other thing around, and I know it's to do with contracts, and it's how difficult is it to get the workforce there and get accommodation? And I know this just from people who stay in the area I'm in. Winter rates are cheap. In the summer, they rely on the tourists, and these workers were moved off the A9 and away. And they had found it very difficult to get accommodation. They were having to travel. So it was not an attractive prospect for anybody who's employed in that industry, having to travel huge distances to get to these sections.
Civil engineering work, it involves a great deal of overnight travel and all the rest of it. So those who work in this particular industry are familiar with having to work away from home. You're absolutely correct, is that one of the real challenges is in the north of Scotland is accommodation for the workforce. And it's not just the A9 we're talking about here. There's a huge amount of work in renewables in the civil engineering section over the next decade. And getting the workforce is going to be key to that. One of the issues of using Indigenous Scottish contractors is they have that workforce. They are local in some cases, they stay local. So that would be the attraction for using contractors that are Indigenous to Scotland or the UK. Having European contractors coming in, that would be a significant problem for them, is that they don't have a workforce. They would have to find one from somewhere.
Another question?
Mr Mountain.
Thank you, Convener. Before I say anything else, I should remind members of my declaration of interest on the register, in the sense that I have a tourist business relating to a fishery where people have to travel up the A9, and I travel up the A9 at least twice a week, probably more likely 4 or 5 times a week. So I do have an interest in it. I would just say that, and I want to question you, Graham, if I may, about the procedure. I mean, we saw the Aberdeen Peripheral Road go out to a joint venture agreement, and the King Craig to Dalraddy section go out to a joint venture agreement. Interesting, King Craig to Dalraddy was always said it was opened on time. A load of nonsense. It was opened on the right day and then closed the day after to be resorted out because it hadn't been done. Do you think joint ventures where the government pays the joint venture all the money and then allows them to decide which subby gets paid or doesn't get paid is the right way to do it?
Joint ventures are a fairly standard approach where contractors will share risk, financial risk on larger projects, not wishing to do them all themselves. How you can ensure that the, and I do believe Transport Scotland do this anyway, is that they put clauses in contracts to make sure that the principal contractors do pay their subcontractor chain in a timely manner. I represent companies across all parts of the supply chain, some who are perhaps first-tier, second-tier, and even third-tier contractors. I think the key to a client using that and making it work properly is actually monitoring it and having proper KPIs around payment down the supply chain just to make sure it's done. And you also have other mechanisms by which you can have making sure that money goes down and it's not at risk with the contractors.
So, but if the cost overruns happen, and they are part of life and on a fixed-term contract with an agreed sum, somebody's going to have to bear the loss somewhere, so it will be up to the joint venture to decide which subcontractor gets saddled with that loss. Is that not the inevitable outcome?
No, because if you take the Aberdeen Western Peripheral, you had three contractors there, all who shared the loss in that. So they took huge losses on that.
So if I'm a subcontractor to one of these joint ventures and I'm tendering and I'm taking all the risk and there's a chance on history's historical events that there's going to be a loss on it, would I not want to make sure my price is so high that it makes sure that I don't actually get a loss?
I think how people pull together pricing on a job, they will go out to... If there's just one contractor, one principal contractor on the Tamat and Tamoi, they will go out to a subcontractor with packages. But they will go out and they will try and find the most competitive package. So they will go out for tender, essentially. So you then have your tier twos who are tendering to the tier ones. So risk is shared along the way. And yes, there's risk involved if a project goes wrong.
From my experience as a surveyor, if you put the risk on somebody, they will make sure they inflate the price to make sure that the risk to their company is such that they will be able to survive at the end of it. So surely it's not the best way of getting the best price. If the risk is shared not only between the person who is carrying out the work, but also the person commissioning the work, because the person commissioning work must know that industry must need to survive, surely that's a more equitable system, which will encourage people then to take part in the tendering process.
Absolutely.
And that's not what we have, is it?
No.
Thank you, Convener.
Yes, of course.
A second. It's just yourself, Mr. Torrance, with direct regard to tourism and the hold-up if we start, you know, dueling roads sequentially. When the E9 gets closed for the accident investigators to go out, it's quite often shut for 24 hours. Now, recently, when it was shut, they divert traffic, and it was a 70-mile diversion. This is across the Dava Moor, which is completely—it's mostly single-track road. It's completely inappropriate for HGVs, which were having to use it. It also puts the HGV drivers against a tackle. It was taking them miles out of their way. Also, if there's an accident on that road, we're completely stuck because it is really quite a remote and barren road as well. So by the time the A9 shut to then divert round, it's surely, you know, as far as tourism is concerned, better to get somebody there safely and slowly than have roads shut for 24 hours or diversions that take another 3 to 4 hours and completely inappropriate roads for tourists.
Mr. Torrance, is that
anyone? Listen, as somebody who's been caught several times, especially going to the Harley-Davidson rally with diversions there, and let's just say waiting for 6 hours, I don't think some of the communities, people would not travel if they had to wait that length of time for diversions, especially to places like Aviemore and the ski industry and things like that, where there's other alternatives, area ski resorts in the area off the A9. So I think a long delay...
I'm talking specifically if it's been closed because of an accident and the delay then.
I said earlier that I promised we would come to one other aspect of the petition, which is the National Memorial, and Alexander Stewart, I think, wants to raise questions relating to that.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. Yes, in part of the petition you brought forward, the memorial is one of your wishes, one of your wants, but it would appear that Transport Scotland have dismissed that because they believe that there could be road safety fears with reference to that memorial. And as I say, I commend you for bringing forward that proposal within your petition. But what is your view and how do you respond to Transport Scotland, who have, as I say, in the reading that I've looked at and the papers they've provided, are quite dismissive of that proposal?
I mean, first of all, it's not my wish. You know, this has come forward from the communities and the people that we've interacted and communicated with. And I think I need to make it quite clear. We don't mean a small roadside memorial at the side of the road. We mean a specific memorial. And it would need to be specific either, you know, to Highland Perthshire or to Invernessshire or somewhere in the mid-ground. And it would very much be off the road, be a very specific memorial garden. We're not talking half a dozen names here, after all. We're talking over 330 odd names. So it is a substantial way. And I also see that as a way and a means to an apology and an acceptance of what has happened to these families. I do think it would be an apology to the communities as to what has gone on.
And I, as I say, I commend you for that, because I do think something of that size and something of that stature is what is required if you wish to ensure that these individuals are remembered in the correct manner. And I would certainly commend you for that. But as you've indicated, you've got some ideas as to where that might take place, or and what kind of discussion have you had with the communities or with areas that may well wish to have that memorial within their location?
It's something obviously we need to fully explore, and obviously, you know, before that kind of thing could happen, you know, you different communities are going to have to speak to families and stuff like that. So it's very much a kind of foundling interest that was brought to us, that we really should acknowledge that this has went on within the Highlands.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you very much. And just before we draw this part of our evidence taking to a conclusion, I wonder if there's anything finally either of our witnesses feel they might want to contribute on which we've not just touched yet. No. Can I ask one question then, which just intrigues me? I mean, I have colleagues here who are immersed in the realities of the A9, on which I am a sometime traveller. Who first said, in the context of this project, who first said 2025? Who advised them to say 2025? And was 2025 ever realistic?
I can't answer the question as to who advised the person to say it. It was obviously a minister, I would imagine, at that time who have said that. I think it was realistic at that time, but it needed commitment to do it straight from the beginning and real commitment over time to do it. And I think that's what we've not had here.
Thank you. And I know Mr. Ewing would just like to come in briefly.
Just ask one final question of the Laura Hansler, which is, I know that petitioner has not only come here today, but has been extensively involved in taking this forward in other ways in the media and directly lobbying. And I believe that she may have reached out across the political spectrum in order to try to garner support. And I think that's always a good thing, where there's a cross-party support, as I hope there is there. I just wanted to ask if the petitioner has done this and what response she has received from the various parties she's approached.
I spoke to every party within Parliament, and I must admit I've had a lot of support. I can only say there's one party that has not supported me, that really kind of stonewalled it, to be honest. And I was exceptionally disappointed with their comments. I've been disappointed with the comments in Chamber regarding Gillian A9. And they're really quite concerning, some of the comments that I've heard. The Greens.
Thank you.
On which note, I will thank both our witnesses very much for their evidence this morning. And thank you both for your contribution. And just have a short suspension while we change witnesses. Thank you. come back again to our second session in relation to petition number 1992. And we're joined now by representatives from Transport Scotland. I'm delighted to see we have Lawrence Shackman, Robert Galbraith and Morag Mackay. And they, of course, I think have been avidly following our proceedings this morning. I've noticed them faithfully sitting through all our deliberations on other petitions as well as the one before us just now. And I think it would be helpful if we move to questions. And, of course, if there's anything you'd like to make by way... Is there any opening statement you want to make? Are you content to move to questions?
No, just to say that we all have the utmost sympathy for those involved in accidents on the A9. And I know it's been used several times before, but one life lost is certainly one too many, and there's nothing good to be said about having accidents on the A9, so we truly recognise that.
Thank you for that. And, I mean, that may play to the discussion we want to have about the National Memorial and perhaps a misunderstanding on all parties about where such a thing might be cited or the desirability of it. We can come to that. Colleagues I know are very interested in this. So, I mean, I'll kind of start where I finished in the last petition, because I'm just, if I can be the daft laddie in all of this in relation to the petition. But did Transport Scotland ever advise the Scottish Government Minister that the A90 could not be that the A9 could be completed by 2025? And if not, did they warn the Scottish Minister who gave this assurance to the public some years ago, and particularly to all those who regularly use the road, that this was not a target that actually could be fulfilled by Transport Scotland?
In answer to your question, obviously that happened a long time ago, and I don't know what advice the Minister of the day was actually given. What I can say is that it was an aspiration to dual it by 2025, quite a big achievement to achieve it by 2025, and I know Graham Barn thought that it was achievable, and I think with a fair wind perhaps it could have been, but there have been many events along the way which have prevented that happening, and obviously was referred to by Ms Gilruth when she was Transport Minister in her statement on the 8th of February this year.
Well, were ministers adhering to this date of 2025 sort of on a wish and a prayer, or did they continue to believe that this was achievable?
Well, it got to a stage leading up to that statement in 2022 where it became abundantly clear that 2025 was not achievable, even allowing for, and as members of the committee have heard today, even allowing for building every section of the A9 concurrently, it would have been impossible to achieve 2025. Obviously, given that each section would take maybe 3 years, depending on which size of section you were looking at. Yeah, during 2022, it was very much apparent, and towards the end, hands up, and obviously with the Tomatin Tamoy issue, it was clear that ministers needed to make a statement to say that 2025 wasn't achievable.
Well, okay, which...
Maybe I could also add that over the period 2020 to 2023, obviously, there'd been a lot of things going on in the world which didn't exactly help progress on the A9 dualling. Obviously, the COVID pandemic, which actually stopped construction for a while.
We do understand that. We're very familiar from ministerial replies to every other deficiency in public life that there was a pandemic. Yeah. Because the number of things that that pandemic has been responsible for, not least the tragic consequences of it in the first instance. But I know Mr Ewing is going to come in first off, and then Mr Chowdhury. Mr Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning to the witnesses. You'll have read the statement provided by Mr Barn and heard his evidence this morning. It's very clear, I think, what he's saying. He does praise the professionalism of yourself, Mr Shackman, and your colleagues, and I would endorse that. But the praise does somewhat end there, and he does go on to say in his statement that Transport Scotland from a civil engineering contractor's point of view, are the worst client in Britain. Now, that's no personal comment. It's based on his assessment, which you've heard, that as far as road building in Scotland is concerned, your contract, your form of contract, your passage of all the risk to the contractor, who have got minimal margins of profit at 2%, has resulted in the completely unacceptable outcome of there being only one bidder in two contracts, Hodigan Roundabout and Tamatin Tamoy, when the whole purpose of a tender process is to attract competitive bids. So it's failed. So would you accept, and I'm not trying to catch you out here, but would you accept that the current procedure is just not fit for purpose, and therefore what we now need to do is move on from that without overly recriminating about the past, we can't do anything about that, but to move on, to work out together, and perhaps this committee can help, in how we solve this problem of getting a form of contract, a form of procurement, which, provided the Scottish Government's willing to put up the money, and that's not your responsibility, that's theirs, can actually deliver the swift completion of this project of duelling the A9, for all the reasons that the petitioner so eloquently and passionately set out in her opening statement.
I don't disagree with Graham Barn about our current form of contract. It's been in place for many, many years, well over 20 years, and when I first started working in what was known as construction branch, when around the time of devolution, it was still being used heavily. We were getting a lot of good tenders, and although it's not written in our contract, we've always tried to collaborate as best we can with contractors to help solve problems along the way and to minimise risks. But as time's gone by, and Mr. Barn pointed this out, attitudes have changed, and we need to have collaboration at the heart of our contract. So I would accept what he said. We do need to move forward. And actually, when I came into my role as project director 18 months ago, I think one of the first meetings I had with Graham was, I did say at the time that I cannot see a future for our form of contract at the moment. What the alternative form of contract is very much up for discussion at the moment within Transport Scotland and our advisers. And obviously we're informing ministers of how we should go forward appropriately so that we can balance value for money for the public purse against making sure that the contractors make a reasonable profit, because we don't want to see contractors making losses. That's not in anyone's interest. And as Graham has said, 80% of his members are work for Transport Scotland. So if they're not making a profit, they're not going to tender for us. So we need to come together to make sure that we do get a consensus and we get a reasonable risk profile for contractors making a reasonable profit, at the same time getting good value for the public purse. And that isn't an easy thing to do. And when we talk about the NEC type of contract, for example, there's different varieties of NEC contracts. There's not just one, and risk profiles can vary within the NEC contract. So you could have a base, I'm trying to say this in very simple terms, you can have a fairly basic NEC contract, but there are certain clauses that you can adjust back to increase the risk profile. With Transport Scotland's particular contract at the moment, we could vary our risk profile very much towards an NEC contract. And what it means for us, I think, is a balance between how we manage our contracts going forward through the construction period, and we tend to have a lot of the commercial discussions at the end of the contract, whereas with the NEC contract, those commercial discussions and issues that happen during the course of construction are dealt with there and then. So it's a different sort of style of managing those contracts, which is also something we need to look at.
You know, I understand these are all complex matters, and I know that you've been in regular dialogue with SECA and you meet them several times a year. What I don't understand, and I don't not say this to be recriminatory, is you've admitted mea culpa, the system is broken, it's not fit for purpose, it's patently so. So that's been obvious for quite a long time. So my question is, particularly over the past couple of years of this session of Parliament, surely this advice about precisely how the contract should be changed so that risk sharing is used and perhaps some form of the contracts are set out for Mr. Barn. Surely that advice should have been given back in 2021 at the latest. Why haven't we made more progress more quickly? Mr. Barn referred to glacial progress. Is he right on that as well?
Well, I think the Tamatin to Moy procurement has really crystallised this issue. So, except, you know, we've been looking at potential to change our contracts for a while, but over the 20 years plus that we've been using the contract, it has given the public a good surety, or it's given ministers a good surety of outturn cost compared with the tender cost. And I think for a long period, it was about a 3% variation between tender costs and outturn costs. So in terms of protecting the public purse, it was very effective. But I do agree that the risk profile is very much being looked at as we speak.
Two further questions. Was it the case that Transport Scotland did, in fact, do some work which hasn't been made public, which was considering some use of private finance, but by the time that work came to fruition, we'd seen the financial crisis kind of emerge and the interest rates rise so that option no longer became applicable. Is that the case? And if that is so, you know, can you share with us the document showing what consideration has been given to all these matters? I appreciate that that decision may not be for you, it may be for the Scottish Government, because there is under FOI, and you've been FOI'd in these kind of things frequently, an exemption to cover ministers' desirability of having candour of internal discussions, and that has been invoked in an FOI I've seen recently about A96, for example. But have you actually been giving advice to ministers on this? Will you share it with us? Have you been considering the options that were set out by Mr. Barnes? Did you leave it too late? Because by the time you'd come up with the proposal, the interest rates had risen, making the finance package unaffordable. I mean, are you able to share what work you've been doing over the past 2.5 years on all of this with us today?
Do you want to I'll maybe take that question, Mr. Ewing. We've been doing work for quite some considerable time looking at comparing options, and fundamentally we're comparing procuring a series of design and build contracts using capital funding versus procuring a smaller number of private finance contracts using resource funding as alternative options. We had significantly advanced in that work last year, and we're getting towards a point of preparing to put advice to ministers when some of the fundamental assumptions that underpin, in particular, the private finance solution, which relies on cost of borrowing assumptions, began to change in a very volatile fashion with the aftermath of the UK government mini-budget in September, I think it was. And it took several months for that to begin to settle down. It's not really a case of leaving it too late. We've had to go back and redo that work. We've had to look again at what the base assumptions that we can make to make that comparison. And that will form advice that will be brought forward to ministers when that work is complete. So we've had to effectively go back and redo a whole series of work.
Could I put to you the point that Mr. Barn made, that there are four of the sections that have made orders, and two of them, the made orders, were made well over a year ago, the other two more recently, but still some time ago. Now, what he said was that as soon as that reaches that point, then these contracts are ready to go. They're ready to press the button. They're ready to go into procurement, provided the Scottish Government provided the money. Did you ask the Scottish Government to provide the money for each of these contracts as soon as they reached each of these sections, as soon as they reached made orders? And if so, what was the response?
I'll maybe pick up to start with, and my colleague might want to come back in. So in the comparison I've described between a series of design and build options versus a smaller number of PFI contracts, one of the features of PFI contracts, to make that attractive to competitive parties, you have to offer a pipeline of bidding opportunities. If you start to subtract elements of what would make up that pipeline of bidding opportunities, you no longer have a PFI option available to you. So in trying to get to a position where you've got a comparison between approaches, taking elements of one approach out would make that approach fundamentally impossible to deliver in the future. So that's a reason why it would be difficult to do what you're suggesting.
Are you saying that you haven't been held back by the lack of funding from the Scottish Government? Because there is there is a feeling, and you know, I've been quite critical of my own government, and because I don't think the delays can be justified or defended in any way, and I've said that. I think it's disgraceful, and I'm sad to say that, but that's what I've said. But I think we want to know to what extent the Scottish Government have had the money ready, but you haven't got the process ready, or to what extent you've asked for money, but you haven't got yes as an answer. We need to know this in this inquiry, and moreover, frankly, the public has got a right to know.
I think to a large extent it's been, I hate to use this phrase, but it's been chicken and egg, because one of the key things is knowing which procurement route is best to be able to package up the sections to then be able to ask for the correct amount of money and what sort of money that is, whether it's capital or revenue, because obviously the PPP will require sums of money into the future, whereas the capital-based projects will need money up front. So there's a different, completely different profile with the financing. So to try and get out of that is quite a difficult conundrum.
I just finish by saying I appreciate all this is complex, and I don't detract from what Mr. Shankman says in any way, but I do think that we need to get to the bottom of this, and I would personally like Transport Scotland to produce the documentation showing the exchange of views, submissions, emails, other documents between Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government, so that, convener, we can get to the bottom of this matter for the sake of the petitioner and for the sake of all of those who've lost their lives on this road over far too long.
But if I could just say, we have been, as you mentioned, FOI'd on all of these aspects ad infinitum in recent times. So a lot of, if not all of the information, I should say, is out there. But we are corralling our...
I've just been refused some information on or at least information has been refused under FOI because of internal candour. And that's the information I'm talking about, specifically about value for money, about the sufficiency of Scottish Government funding and the interchange between you and the Scottish Government on this. So as long as that is not published, then there will be unanswered questions, frustration, anger and irritation, and that just won't go away. So the sooner the Scottish Government do what they did in the Holyrood Inquiry in 2001, I think it was, or 2003, and the more recent Salmon Inquiry, and publish the available advice notes, convener, the better for our work and, more important, for the public interest.
Okay, thank you. Can I welcome Kate Forbes to our proceedings this morning? I will invite you to comment after we've heard the evidence, but I have unusually this morning agreed that if there is a point during the proceedings where you'd like to put a question to the witnesses, if you can let me know, then I'll be happy to facilitate that as well. Mr. Chowdhury and then Mr. Mountain.
Thank you very much. I think it's very clear that 2025 is not possible anymore. Do we have a date in mind that when it could be? And for the time being, is there any emergency procedures are taken so no more accidents happens? Or, I mean, what's the temporary measures? Is there any at all?
Can I just start by saying that the ministers have... mentioned several times that they are going to make a statement in autumn about how the A9 is going to be taken forward, timescale, and what and when. So that is still planned to be taken forward in the autumn. With regard to short-term measures in terms of road safety, I think Morag, you can...
Yeah, the Minister advised government that there would be £5 million put towards measures last financial year and the two next financial years. And what we have done is we've worked with stakeholders, we've worked with Police Scotland and the road safety professionals within the operating company that covers A9 to understand the causations of the accidents that we've seen on A9, and we've targeted measures to look towards that. So there is a £5 million package of works that's been undertaken, and we've started that ostensibly from the Burnham, from Luncotay to the Dalgais, Burnham to Dalgais section. That's the first single carriageway section as you travel north, and we picked that section specifically because it is the first section, it's the first single section that you come off. And it was also because we were doing the measures over winter, they were less likely to be affected by the winter weather. And the measures include signing road markings, and we're looking to improve the transitions between the dual and single to make them more conspicuous. We've increased the lining. We're using specific product which has better reflectivity and better acoustic to target issues with regards to drifting of vehicles on single carriageways. They basically hear a rumble when they go over the white lines. We've also put in mobile variable message signs to deliver messages, road safety messages as well. And we've started down that section, but we will continue with the other single sections going forward.
Sorry, are this published or has it been given to the people in the area? And as you've said, that 2025, do you still think is achievable?
No, the 2025 isn't achievable, and the former minister said that in her statement in February. And that's where why we're going to come back, or ministers will come back in the autumn with a revised timeline.
Thank you. I'll come to Mr Fraser before Mr Mountain, if I may, because Mr Chowdhury's question touched on, I think, a point that Mr Fraser raised with our previous witnesses that he'd like to pursue again just now. So, Mr Fraser.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you for bringing me in. I'd just like to see if you can shed any light on this rather curious issue that I raised just a moment ago with the previous witnesses. So I'm just finding the exact reference here. Yes, there was a government-initiated question lodged on Monday afternoon in the name of Jim Fairley, MSP, which said to ask the Scottish Government when the new procurement for the dualling of the A9 between Tamatan and Moy will commence. Now, as I'm sure you're aware, the purpose of a government-initiated question is to allow a statement to Parliament to be made, and therefore such questions are only lodged when a statement is ready. Curiously, in this case, and I've never come across this before, Convener, this question was not answered, and in fact this morning has been withdrawn, which seems rather extraordinary. And I was wondering if you could shed any light on this.
Well, I believe the reason for its withdrawal is because, as you're aware, there's a new Transport Minister, and the view was taken that she should be given time to have a think about this issue and make her own decision on how it should be taken forward. So I think that's the reason.
That's helpful in terms of understanding the context, although we knew, of course, on Monday when the question was lodged that we didn't have a Transport Minister at that point. But anyway, that's a matter for the Scottish Government. Perhaps the committee can pursue that separately.
Does that mean then there was something that was going to be announced which has now been deferred in order that the new Transport Minister be given the opportunity to reflect on its content?
That's for ministers to answer, not for me.
Right. The other question I put to Mr. Barnes. So the previous transport minister, we've now gone through two new transport ministers, but Jenny Gilruth, when she was transport minister, told Parliament, I think back beginning of the year, I think, that on the Tamatan to Moy section, she would hope to make an announcement by the end of this year in terms of the award of a contract. Now, what Mr. Barn told us was that, given the likely timescale, 6 months to award a contract would be very tight. So are you in a position to tell us any more about the procurement process for that section?
No, we're still working through that. And yes, I would agree, it is extremely tight to award by the end of the year. That is certainly a target we're aiming for, but we'll have to wait and see on when the new minister has decided on the procurement route and when that should be launched.
Right. So going back to the conversation we just had with Mr. Ewing about the type of contract, you're still proceeding on the basis of the existing contract, or are you looking to adjust that for the Tamatan to Moy section?
Using the existing contract is highly unlikely. Highly unlikely.
Right. But it does sound like there's a lot of work to be done still before you even put this out to tender.
No, there isn't actually too much to do, because remember we had the original Tamatan to Moy contract, and the vast majority of that is where we want the road to go, how wide it is, where we want curbs and where we don't want curbs, that sort of thing. So all of that is in the bank, so to speak. It's actually the front-end contract. Is it an NEC contract? Is it Transport Scotland's terms and conditions heavily modified? That actually isn't going to take too much longer to do.
Okay. And the process would be you publish, presumably you publish a tender document, do you? And then there's a period you have to wait for responses.
We'd publish a tender notice, yeah.
Yeah.
And then that would be an advert to assign to the market that we're going to procure the. That's the start of the procurement, basically.
Okay. Yeah. And can you give us any indication when you expect that to be done?
I can't at the moment, no, because that's subject to the new minister and other ministers being involved in that.
But the clock is clearly ticking in terms of trying to get this awarded by the year end as promised to Parliament.
It is, yes.
Okay. Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. Mr. Mountain.
Two areas of question. First of all, when do you start the compulsory purchase order stage for the land that you want to acquire to build the road?
So the statutory process is once a project has got through the preferred route stage and we advertise that, we invite the public and stakeholders, anyone with an interest in the scheme to see the material that's been produced, the environmental assessment report, the draft road and compulsory purchase orders are all put out into the public domain. If we get objections to that process, people don't like a particular part, it could be an affected landowner or a statutory body, for example, then we may need to go through a public inquiry process. A reporter will be appointed and they will make a decision. On some of the sections, we've had to go through a public inquiry process. On some of the sections, we've been fortunate in many ways that we haven't had to have a public inquiry. And ministers are then decided that they will make the orders. And some of the sections have got the orders made, which means that we have a 3-year period to actually vest the land before we would have to go back to the start and promote the scheme again. And in some cases, we haven't, we're yet to make the orders. So that is also part of what we plan to announce in the autumn as to how that is going to be managed going forward. I would say that in terms of the procurement process, any of the orders, making the actual orders and vesting the land isn't a constraint on the timescale for actually constructing the projects, albeit that we haven't got the Dunkeld section through that process yet.
But if somebody objects to a compulsory purchase order, there is quite a complex process to go through, which will take, could take, years rather than months?
As long as it can only be on the process, once the orders are made, then they cannot really object to the making of the compulsory purchase orders and the purchase of the land unless there's some sort of problem with the legality of how we've made it. So, it's been through due process by that stage.
It was made. There's nothing to stop the road being built?
No. Just buying the land is the thing after that, and then
the compensation at the end of it.
Yes,
that's all wrapped up. Once that's agreed.
Yeah.
Okay. Convener, if I can go back to the question I asked in the first section about sharing risk, and you've alluded, Lawrence, to that during this today. Do you think that by coming up with a new contract, you will convince subcontractors across the Highlands, possibly, who will be tendering for this, that they really will not be left hanging out to dry because they have in the past? And a lot of them have spoken to me about it and are unhappy about it. Do you think you can rebuild those bridges?
Well, I would be surprised if they weren't a major part of during the A9 because of its location. Even if we were to go for the PPP, the public-private finance type option, where we would be likely, as Mr. Barn mentioned, attract a lot more foreign construction companies, they still need local labour, they still need local materials, they need people in the locale to actually be able to construct the road. And we're talking about a huge amount of road building here. You know, it's It's something that's comparable to the upgrading of the A74 back in the 80s and 90s. It's, you know, that sort of scale where you had 10, 11 contracts. So, you know, we found a way back in that time to build those contracts, so I don't see why there's any reason why local labour and suppliers can't be heavily involved. I mean, this was a question, as you will know yourself, that was asked many times when we were building the Queensferry Crossing. You know, we had a lot of contractors involved in that project from abroad, but they used a huge amount of local labour and local supplies, and that was a regular topic that was discussed at committee meetings for the Queensferry Crossing. And I believe the same thing for Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, which Rob was heavily involved in.
I remember discussing them clearly on the Aberdeen peripheral route when I was on the REC committee, and also the Kincraig to Dalrady bit, and the fact that a lot of people got their fingers burnt in the process and are nervous about the process in the future. So my final question is, do you think you've got some bridges to build, metaphorically speaking, before bridges can be built on the A9?
We would always encourage ourselves, we will always engage with the industry and supply chain as much as they'll let us, to be honest. We're more than happy to do that. We have initiatives where we always ask our Tier 1 contractors to advertise any opportunities on the Procurement Scotland portal, which was something that was pioneered on the Queensferry Crossing, and now it's a standard way of doing things. We also have touched on earlier, we have project bank accounts on our projects, so we ensure that Tier 2 and beyond suppliers and subcontractors get paid on time, so they don't have to wait for payment. And that's a system that's working really well, and we have that on all our projects. So there are a number of things we're doing to try and make sure that we embrace the local suppliers as far as we possibly can, and we will continue to do so. Did you want to add something?
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And to return to the point that we raised with the petitioner's ambition for a national memorial, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Yes. It would be useful to get a flavour now of your views and opinions with reference to this proposed memorial, because it would appear from your comments previously, as I indicated when I asked the petitioner, that you were dismissing this type of memorial on the grounds of road safety concerns. And now that you've heard from the petitioner what maybe the intention is, I mean, do you have a similar view, or has your view been changed?
Do you want to take that forward?
Yes, thank you. We did respond based on it being by the roadside, and gave the reasons for that, given we follow guidance from the Scots with regards to roadside memorials. But I appreciate the petitioner has suggested that it's somewhere else, it's more localised, maybe in a community on A9. It's something we haven't considered, obviously, because we thought the ask was about the roadside, so that can be considered further. But what I would say that, tragic as the lives we have lost in A9, we have to recognise across Scotland the road deaths, and we have to be mindful of doing something specifically for the A9 as opposed to people that have lost loved ones on the other roads across Scotland.
I acknowledge that, but I think the case that was made, and the strong case within the communities, the length and breadth of the A9 being the, you know, the spine of the country, as it's been called, I think that the ability to do something of this nature would go a long way to manage some of that community involvement, and look forward to hearing how that may progress, depending on how things move forward.
Might we ask Transport Scotland to reflect on that fact, just given the evidence of the petitioner this morning, and perhaps having reflected on it, just to give us a flavour of what they think it might be possible or not for us to consider further at another date. I'm very grateful for that. Are there any other questions from colleagues? No. One from Mr. Ewing.
Just one. I mean, is there a risk that the re-tender of Tamaton Tamoy will lead to an even higher price, as we heard Mr. Barn elucidate? And secondly, could you answer his point and his recommendation that, you know, whereas one must in a tender process be, treat all parties equally, that's a plain, clear legal requirement of procurement, that doesn't actually prevent you from reaching out to all the contractors to inquire as to their progress, provided they're asked the same questions, in order to be able to ascertain if it's likely that you end up in the same situation again, where you end up with one bidder only, but this time at an even higher price than the price that was previously rejected because it itself was deemed too high?
Well, firstly, I would say through our Transport Scotland process, we use the process to speak to the contractors during the development of their proposals, because they're responsible for the design and for the construction. It's not just the construction, so they're fully responsible for coming up with a competent, fully embracing all the requirements of the contract in their design. So we do have consultation meetings through the procurement process with each individual contractor and their confidential meetings. And yes, we ask for an update on how they're doing with their design, how they're likely to be building the contract. Their methods and are very important to understand. We actually in the Tamatin to Moy project, partway through the process, did ask them if they thought our tender estimate, which is the middle figure, is 115 million. You're correct, and I think that was at April 2021 prices. And actually, the two tenderers, putting the first one who withdrew to one side, both thought that that was a reasonable estimate partway through the process. So I don't quite know what happened with the one bid, why they put in their bid to the value that they did, not wishing to reveal the commercial in confidence aspects of that. But we do engage fully with contractors, and we do try, although the contractors don't particularly like our terms and conditions, we do try to de-risk as much as possible. For example, through the tender period, we offer them the chance to do, or we will undertake an additional ground investigation. And I think on Tamatin to Moy, that was about £1 million. So it's a pretty substantial extra ground investigation to help de-risk the project and get the contractor in a place where they can put in a competent price. And that's one of the methods that we use all the way through our alternative tendering initiative projects.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all very much. That's been very much appreciated. Is there any final point you would like to touch on that we've not addressed?
Just to say that we are fully committed to dualling the A9. We're looking to see what the autumn statement, or I'm sure everyone is looking to see what the autumn statement will hold.
Yes,
and,
sure.
And the First Minister only 2 days ago, as you all know, made a strong commitment, a very strong commitment to dualling the A9.
And many other things. but thank you very much. My two parliamentary colleagues who've joined us this morning, all comes before R. So Kate Forbes, would you like to just address comments to the committee that we can take into account as we consider the petition?
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener, for having me here. And sincere thanks to Laura Hansler and the A9 Dual Action Group for bringing this petition before the committee and indeed raising the profile of this issue. And I think it is the product of frustration, yes, but also grief at the number of fatalities on the road and also the accidents and the near misses, which don't get recorded. I wanted to make some very, very brief comments about this not just being a Highlands problem. This is very much an issue of national concern. And I believe it's a concern for three reasons. The first is that there is no transition to net zero without dualling the A9. Now, that is contrary to arguments that have been made about this being inconsistent with our move to net zero. But actually, the Highlands and Rural Scotland disproportionately relies on, for example, car use. And we must have an electrified dualled A9 for safe use. Secondly, it is reliant on it for economic reasons, which has already been covered, and thirdly, reliant on it when it comes to safety. And that third reason is perhaps the most important above everything else. There is a cast iron guarantee to dual the A9. What we are exercised about is seeing the timetable and ensuring that that timetable is backed up with appropriate procurement processes, which have come in for some criticism, and also with a budget. Now, I know the constraints in our budget. With a £5 billion capital budget every year and an A9 dualling programme that costs £3 billion, quite clearly, this needs to be prioritised, and that will mean difficult decisions elsewhere. But I think such is the importance of this project, we need to see that prioritisation and that funding in there. So that's all I have to say, because I think it's been adequately covered. But I really cannot stress the importance of this programme to both my constituents, but also to those whose lives have been affected as they wait for the updated timetable, including those subject to compulsory purchase orders, who have been waiting in some cases for almost a decade for this to go through, and whose house sales, for example, have been affected. And it also impacts the rest of Scotland, three really important groups that want answers. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Ms Forbes. And thank you too for referencing again the petitioner on whose behalf we are pursuing our inquiry this morning. And finally, Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. You've been very very kind in letting me ask some questions. I'll be very brief in just making some final comments. And I should say my colleague, Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, who represents Highlands and Islands, had hoped to be here, but he's in another committee this morning. So he's clearly interested in this matter too. And just as Kate Forbes said, this affects the Highlands, but elsewhere, it affects my constituents in Perth and Kinross as part of the Mid-Scotland and Fife region, who have very similar concerns about not just the accident rate on the A9, but the economic impact of that road not being dualled. I think it's been very helpful this morning, actually, hearing from the petitioners and indeed from Transport Scotland. And we await with interest hearing what will happen on the Tamatin-Tamoy section. And it does sound like some announcements are imminent there, we would hope. But that, of course, is only one section out of the whole remaining sections of the A9. It does sound like the preparatory work is done in all but one section, the one at Dunkeld. So the only issue holding up progress is finance, if the contract issues can be dealt with, and that really is a matter of political will and priorities. So, you know, referencing back to the petitioner's comments at the very start about the number of people who've died, sadly, you know, we're entering peak tourist season. You know, you dread turning the news on in the morning because you hear about people who've lost their lives on the A9. Some of these are visitors to Scotland who've come on a family holiday and lose their lives on the A9. And that will continue, sadly, until we see this road project finally completed. So I would encourage the committee, if it needs any encouragement, to be like terriers in pursuing this particular matter to a conclusion and to continue to press Scottish Government for some definite timescale that the petitioner is looking for.
Thank you, Mr Fraser. And although, as I said earlier, the A9 is a route I'm on occasionally, in an earlier time in my political life, the A77 from Eastwood to Ayr was notorious in terms of the loss of life that took place on that, and that issue was resolved with the dualling of that section. And I think at one point more people lost lives on that road than any other annually in Scotland. So it is obviously something which is the ultimate and only reliable way in which we can hope to provide a safe journey and, as I think Kate Forbes has said, achieve other objectives which are in the national interest as well. Thank you all very much. Can I just ask my colleagues in the committee if they are content to consider the evidence we heard both from the Lord Advocate and in this session at a subsequent time? They are. Then I suspend briefly, thanking again our colleagues who joined us this morning and from Transport Scotland. Very much appreciated. And welcome back. I'll try again, and welcome back. We now move to the further petitions that we are considering this morning. The first of them is petition number 1862, to introduce community representation on the boards of public organisations delivering lifeline services to island communities. This has been lodged by Rona Mackay, Angus Campbell and Naomi Bremer on behalf of the Youst Economic Task Force, and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce community representation on boards of public organisations delivering lifeline services to island communities in keeping with the Island Scotland Act of 2018. And I'm delighted, I think we've had Dr Allen join us before in consideration of this petition, and a warm welcome back to Alistair Allen this morning. We previously considered this petition on the 22nd of February, at which point we agreed to write to the Minister of Transport recommending the Scottish Government explore all the available options to formalise the role of community representation on boards of public organisations, including Caledonian Maritime Assets Limited, CMAL, David McBrain Limited, DML and Highlands and Islands Airports Limited, HIAL. We've received a response from the now former Transport Minister, Kevin Stewart, who agrees that more islanders need to be involved in decision-making on lifeline services. And similar to the response from the previous minister, Jenny Gilruth, Mr Stewart provides information on the efforts to encourage applications from island representatives in recent CMAL and DML recruitment processes. The minister also highlighted HIAL's location-neutral policy for head office roles, which enables staff undertaking head office functions to be based at any of HIAL's sites. We have also received a further submission from the petitioners, which emphasises the unintended consequences which can result from not having islander knowledge on the boards of public bodies, and includes a request to give oral evidence to this committee, which therefore is one of the options open to members this morning. Albeit, I should say, in inviting Dr Allen to address us, that it's also at a stage now where colleagues might think that we've taken the issues of the petition as far forward as we can. But may I invite you to address us and just speak to the petition?
Thank you very much, Convener. And if I could thank the committee for its work on this petition so far. Since the committee last considered the petition, I think it's fair to say that the evidence-based case for having more islander knowledge on public boards has only increased, and the problems with ferry services are well rehearsed, not least regarding South Uist in my constituency, which currently has no ferry service at all running directly to the mainland. And I think a continual theme in all of that and in the petition is one that I've raised in a members' debate and raised in this context as well, which is the strikingly obvious need to have islanders on the boards of organisations like CalMAC, CMAL and so on. And to quote John Daniel Peter Anna from South Uist, the goal has to be to make it as easy to live and work on an island as it is anywhere else. And without the influence of islanders on these public bodies controlling island services, the current depopulation trends will accelerate. Now, there is presently, it must be said, a conspicuous lack of people on these boards who have the experience of living on an island, for instance, that is served by CalMAC, and who therefore have the personal experience of being lobbied in their daily lives outside work about ferries. I think I said in my last contribution to you that perhaps if they were stopped every time they went out to buy a pint of milk and asked about ferries in the way that I am, perhaps they would take a different perspective back to their board meetings. But I think it's also important that people live in communities where they have the experience of consequences of when things go wrong. Everyone understands that boards do not and should not take day-to-day operational decisions in organisations like CalMAC, but as the petitioners put it, they should set the policy, define the way of working and set the culture of the organisation. So it's important to note that the call for more island board members should not be seen in isolation. There is, in my view, a wider need to have more senior staff from organisations like CalMAC and Transport Scotland based in the Highlands and Islands, and to disperse jobs wherever feasible. Finally, Convener, I just want to point out that many islanders, as well as having lived experience of ferry services, for instance, also have a wealth of other experience too, and these are seafaring communities. These skills should be featuring prominently in whatever recruitment exercises these organisations run. And with all that in mind, I'm happy to answer any points the committee has, but I would certainly like again to speak in support of the aims of the petition.
Thank you, Dr. Allen. Can I ask, I mean, in the responses that we've received, there is a general acceptance of the desire to see more community representation on the boards and involvement. The Minister talked about providing information on the efforts that have been made to solicit applications for such representation. I mean, what is your impression against the background of those assurances and that suggestion as to the public perception or lack of any momentum to bring about a realisation of that ambition?
I would acknowledge that the government has made moves in that direction, but I would have to also acknowledge the reality that I think from memory, and someone will correct me, just to take the CMAL board, I think, has one person on it living on an island served by those ferries. And I do not think that as yet CalMAC has anyone on the board who lives in any island which is served by CalMAC. So I think there have been efforts to look at things like the criteria by which people are appointed. Obviously, the government is at the mercy of whether people come forward. The reality is still that these are voices that are not really there on these boards.
I don't think we've really got to the end of this issue. Have we? I mean, I think there is... Well, sorry, colleagues, I'm summing up on behalf of all of you, but I mean, does anybody, do colleagues have any points they would like to make? Mr Ewing?
Yes, I'm just looking through the previous evidence and the points that Dr. Allen made about the desirability of having island residents on public bodies. I also looked at the specific recommendations that the three petitioners have made, and they used High Isle as an example of having a place in the selection panel for the selection of the chair of High Isle. I mean, that could be done for every chair, of every board, CML, Caledonian McBrain and so on. Assigning three seats on the High Isle board to people who live in communities. One of these would be retained for a co-opted member, and then at least one council allocated a place on the board from either Western Isles, Orkney or Shetland Islands Council. So the point I'm making, Convener, is that the petitioners made these very concrete, specific suggestions. These haven't been responded to specifically. Instead, my reading of it, and I hope I'm not being unfair to the former minister, is that he replied with a lot of goodwill, but he didn't specifically respond to the specific suggestions that the petitioners have made. Now, in as much as we are the voice of the petitioner, you know, irrespective of the party issues involved here, it does seem to me that we just haven't really got an answer from the former minister, and we need to get an answer from the current minister as to whether or not these specific suggestions are ones that can be pursued. Now, I mean, there's arguments for and against each of them, but not to have had a reply of any sort means, I think, just what you've said, your premature summation was absolutely correct.
Thank you. Well, the petitioners have very specifically requested that they be given an opportunity to speak to the committee. I think that would have to be a prelude to us trying to bottom out with the new minister exactly how matters could be actually realised, rather than, I think, as you put it, a lot of goodwill, but not necessarily the actual outcome being achieved. Or even the desirability or otherwise of the outcome being suggested actually being assessed and answered. So I think I might be minded to keep the petition open and to accede to that request from the petitioners as a precursor to then speaking to speaking further with the new minister, who I understand was presented as having vast experience of parliamentary life and an ability to resolve even the most intractable of problems. So we'll be very happy to put that ambition to the test. Are we agreed then to keep the petition open and to accede to the petitioner's request on that basis? So that's what we'll do. We'll keep the petition open, and we will, if the petitioners are watching us today, invite them to address the committee, whether online or whether they want to come here or not. That can be decided in due course. And that will be after the summer recess, obviously. Thank you very much, Dr. Allen. We move to petition number 1865, suspend all surgical mesh and fixation devices. A long-standing petition lodged by Rosanna Clarkin and Lauren McDougall. You'll remember we've heard
previously, and calls on the Scottish Government to suspend the use of all surgical mesh and fixation devices, while a review of all surgical procedures which use polyester, polypropylene or titanium is carried out, and while guidelines for surgical use of mesh are established. And we are joined this morning once again by our parliamentary colleagues Jackie Bailey and Katie Clark, both of whom have followed this petition with interest as we have debated it. The last time we, in fact, discussed this petition was some time ago now, on the 28th of September last, where we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and also to seek a parliamentary debate on the issues that were raised in the petition. And members will remember that they probably all participated in that debate on the 17th of January. Ahead of the debate taking place, we also received a response from the then Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport, which highlighted that MHRA proposals to increase the classification of surgical mesh implants. The Minister's response also states that the Scottish Government is taking forward improvements to the recording of procedures and implanted devices, and that the Scottish Association of Medical Directors has been asked to report on the availability of non-mesh surgery in individual health boards. Now, we've also received, again, a submission from the petitioners, which offers their reflections on the evidence the committee has gathered to date and the debate that took place in January, as well as highlighting the difficulties patients are continuing to face in making an informed choice about their treatment and where to seek support when experiencing complications resulting from surgical mesh. And I've certainly received representations in this regard too. No urologist actually being part of the National Centre for Chronic Pain and Mesh Services that we have in Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board, and individuals who are still experiencing difficulty in taking advantage of the opportunity to have mesh removed by a surgeon of their choice at a location of their choice. So maybe characterising slightly as in the last petition, there has been a lot of goodwill. There has also been concrete action in relation to this along the way, but there are still clearly deficiencies in the actual outcome of all of this. And I wonder whether both Jackie Bailey and Katie Clark would like to say a few words to the committee. And I would normally go alphabetically, but I saw Jackie Bailey deferring to Katie Clark. So Katie Clark, if you'd like to speak first.
I'm very grateful, convener, for the opportunity to appear again. I probably should say that I met with both petitioners yesterday. Rosanna is personally affected in that she's one of the individuals who suffered debilitating chronic pain and life-altering injury after undergoing a mesh procedure, and it was Lauren's mother who was affected, who has now passed away. As I say, I met with them yesterday, but I know that the committee has received testimonies from many other individuals who have been affected. As the committee knows, the mesh used in hernia operations is different than with transvaginal mesh, but many of the issues are very similar, and this affects both men and women. But we have a lack of data in terms of the extent of the problem, and that's why the petitioners are asking for an independent review to gather that data, and for the use of surgical mesh and fixation devices to be suspended until such a review is concluded. I myself have put down freedom of information requests to every health board in Scotland. I wanted to know the number of patients who were treated for hernia using surgical mesh and had been readmitted to hospital following complications arising from mesh. Most health boards did not provide information, but some health boards did respond. NHS Ayrshire and Arran revealed that 8% of all patients who were implanted with mesh to treat a hernia in its hospitals were subsequently readmitted due to complications arising from the mesh, and NHS Lanarkshire said the figure was 10%. So I think this data suggests that the petitioners are right to highlight the need for a review to explore the issue further, yet the Scottish Government continues to refuse to engage with them, and indeed the Minister has refused to meet with them, and indeed the former Minister refused to meet with the petitioners directly. So given this lack of engagement with the petitioners from Scottish Ministers, I would urge this committee to consider asking the Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care to appear before the committee and give evidence so we can give further consideration to these issues.
Thank you very much. And Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Convener, and can I acknowledge your own particular contribution to tackling the mesh scandal in Scotland. So I know we will get a good hearing from all of the committee today. Let me start by echoing my colleague Katie Clark's calls for the committee to ask the Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care to appear and give evidence on this issue, but also to give evidence by way of an update on all the promises made by the Scottish Government prior to the debate in January, but I've yet to understand whether those commitments have been fulfilled. There is a need to have a viable and safe alternative to mesh, and this was acknowledged by Marie Todd in a previous committee meeting in June 2022, where she agreed that the skills gap between mesh and natural tissue repair needs to be bridged. I'm keen to know what progress has been made in actually doing that. The petitioners also raised concerns that some patients have very recently had mesh inserted, but there was no discussion about the risks, no discussion about what alternative treatment, if any, could be offered. And I think, and I think we all think, patients in Scotland have the right to have the choice, have the right to make informed decisions about their healthcare, and medical professionals should be given the tools to answer patients' questions about the risks and about the alternatives. It can't be right that patients are relying on each other for information through support groups. There needs to be clear guidance that's shared with all GP practices across every health board. So whilst the Scottish Government have previously said, and I find this hard to believe, but they have said that mesh hernia repair used in Canada at the Shouldice Hospital that we've discussed before wouldn't work for the Scottish demographic. I mean, I really don't understand why that would be the case. But could we explore that? Because I believe that there is still an opportunity to create that national treatment centre to properly offer alternatives and actually to deal with the problems of mesh. I don't think we can continue to deprive those who have had mesh hernia, who require repairs to be undertaken, of options for that treatment and removal. So I would be most grateful if this committee would do the petitioners and all of us a favour by pressing the Scottish Government in this regard. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Ms Bailey. And I mean, it's not a happy thought, but it is exactly 10 years since the committee first considered the issue of mesh in the petition brought forward by Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy. And yes, it would be ungenerous not to acknowledge that five cabinet secretaries later, we have seen progress in relation to the issue. I mean, there have a number, you know, things have happened. The moratorium continues to apply in terms of transvaginal mesh. We have secured the Recompense Bill Act, which provides for women to have the mesh removed by Dr. Veronicus in Missouri. But that there are issues still remaining. And I think that there are questions still that we want to put to the Scottish Government. I take a number of the suggestions that have been made. I too am interested or confused about the shoulders thing. I mean, I kind of understood the Scottish Government's concern that the requirement or the commitment from those who might undergo that surgery required a considerable weight loss and that that might ultimately be selective. But there were very open offers made by the medical staff, Dr. Spencer Netto, I think, who, in giving evidence to the committee, specifically said that they would be willing to offer training and discussion with the Scottish Government as to the processes and procedures that were involved. And I kind of thought there was a willingness to consider that from the government. I've never heard anything further about where that might play in the outcome. So I would very much like to understand what further reflections the Scottish Government has had on the Shouldice model and also the offer that was made to try and offer support to the NHS Scotland in relation to that. Have colleagues got other suggestions that they might like to make? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Kinnean. I think you make some very valid points, and I think Katie Clark and Jackie too also have given us a scenario and situation where we find. So I would be very happy to continue to have the petition move forward. And I think there are a number of options that we could do, and I would suggest the following, that we write to the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, highlighting the petition's latest submission and seeking information on the outcome of the Scottish Association of Medical Directors exercise to explore the availability of non-mesh surgery in individual health boards. I think that's vitally important. And the development of NHS Scotland's scan and safety programme, specifically when it began and how it will be rolled out, I think it also. And I think it's, you know, when we look at hernia, I think that the British Hernia Society, I think we can write to seek their views on the action called for in the petition and information on the work that is going on and developing a hernia-specific registry, I think, is also important. So these are the areas I would suggest.
Although I think, colleagues, we did previously kind of take the view that the actual clinical, in a clinical sense, objective of the petition, which was to rule out mesh in all circumstances, was something we'd heard sufficient evidence on not to support in principle. Is that the point you want to make there, Mr. Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. There's 2 points I want to make. As somebody who has had mesh in them for a long time for a hernia repair, and one of the 90% is very successful for, and it's changed my life. So I would definitely rule out abandoning all mesh implants just now. But the other thing is, on when we're writing to the Scottish Association of Medical Directors, I wonder if we could ask them, because you mentioned one of the parts of the criteria for a shoulders hospital, it is really strict criteria before they will even go ahead with surgery. If that isn't, we could actually put that in and allow, would the public out there accept that strict criteria? Because a lot of them would be rejected on the grounds that they go ahead with operation.
Yes. I mean, and that is a question, but I mean, 6,000 people in Canada annually are being operated on successfully. So there is also the consequential saving to the health service in a patient who has recovered rather than a patient who is an ongoing sufferer and requiring constant additional medical support and treatment. So, I mean, I realise there are issues to weigh up here, but I don't think they should be casually dismissed just because of that. I also think the petitioner, according to Katie Clark's suggestion there, still believes, notwithstanding all the assurances we've heard about the discussion of the consequences and alternatives that are open by way of proper representation of the facts to individuals, is not happening universally. But, and I therefore would be interested, I think, to hear from the Scottish Government or to get the Scottish Government's latest update, because I think when we've had the minister here before, along with the other health officials, there were assurances given to us then that there was further work being done on more updated information material. I think we'd quite like to understand the status of that and the impact of that. And it may well be that all this does lead to us once again seeking to have the Cabinet Secretary, and I think at some stage it might be the Cabinet Secretary rather than just the Minister that we would like to have, because it was the Cabinet Secretary who first came to this committee and on whose initiative a lot of action initially was progressed. But I think that would be a decision just for a subsequent meeting if we can hear more. Any other suggestions? Are we content with that? I think we are. So thank you both very much, and we'll keep the petition open and work forward on that basis. Thank you. We move now to petition number 1962 to stop motorhomes parking overnight out with formal campsites, caravan parks and areas. This has been lodged by Lynn and Darren Redfern, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to improve licensing enforcement on motorhomes to ensure they are only parked in designated and regulated locations. And we previously discussed this on the 23rd of November. When, you members will recall, we were keen to explore the promotion of areas as an alternative solution to the challenges presented by the petitioners. The Scottish Government has stated that a camper van and motorhome working group was set up and has explored the unique challenges created by motorhome and camper van users in Scotland, with facilities being part of its consideration. I do apologise. This group will report on its recommendations to the Visitor Management Steering Group at some point this year.
The petitioner's recent submission states that new facilities will not be effective in addressing the issues raised in the petition and that strict restrictions must be enforced against unregulated camper van parking, wherever that may be taking place. They highlight an incident where a camper van renter was displeased because the rental company had promoted the vehicle as fully self-contained, implying that campsites would not be necessary. The petitioners state that this is mentally... Well, this is the mentality they wish to stem. Sorry. Financial challenges are also highlighted by the petitioner as they are ineligible for support in the way that not-for-profit establishments are. Try to contain the obvious associated hysteria. Are there member comments from members that we might wish to consider?
I think Jackie Bailey wants to
say something. I see Jackie Bailey, who is not formally here to advise us in this petition, but would very much like, and I have been so generous today by bringing in parliamentary colleagues that it would be very churlish of me not to offer you the opportunity.
I am so grateful, Convener. I didn't know I had such an interest in camper vans until now, but I would suggest the committee might want to consider a debate in parliamentary time, given the level of interest that there is.
Thank you very much. I suppose we could also take evidence from camper van homeowners as well, potentially, as a way forward. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener.
Save us from this mischievous hilarity.
Can I just say, Convener, considering if you have road tax on a vehicle, whether it's a camper van or not, you are allowed to park it up anywhere as long as it is not an obstruction, a roadway or a driveway or whatever. So under Rule 15.7 of standing orders, I'm happy to close this petition.
I feel that would be a terrible wasted opportunity, Mr. Turnbull. No. I mean, given that a working group's been set up, might we not want to know what it's done?
Convener, I'm quite happy to close this under 15.7 of standing orders if any of the committee would welcome back me, OK?
Do I have any alternative suggestions from the committee?
That's what they all say.
I think maybe the safest thing for us to do, there is a proposal to close the petition. Are there any alternative suggestions? Mr. Ewing.
I'm going to incur the wrath of Mr. Torrance here, but I just kind of wonder if we've really done justice to the petitioners who have specifically said that they want specific restrictions on overnight parking, and it is a nuisance, there's no doubt, in the Highlands, but also elsewhere. But camper van's a huge vehicle, so it can cause some nuisance issues. So in order to ascertain if this working group is actually going to consider any specific recommendations, maybe we could write to the government to ask if this working group has looked at this issue and what its recommendation is. Are there any measures that could be taken? There could be local bylaw provisions, for example, that might enable Highland Council, for example, to tackle these things. But, to be fair, I think this is one of many businesses operating, I think, a caravan park, and is a particular issue of nuisance for many residents along the NC500, but perhaps in many other places. And if you've got a bloody great camper van parked in somewhere that you kind of need to use or needs to be made available for safety vehicles or whatever, particularly in restricted narrow roads, single track roads, this is in places like Skye, this is a serious issue, although perhaps not necessarily the one which was foremost in everybody's minds as the frivolity and jollity proceeded unabated.
So we do have a proposal to close the petition, or one to ask the Scottish Government whether the Camper Van and Motorhome Working Group has reported to the Visitor Management Steering Group and when the Steering Group is expected to respond to that report.
Yes, I mean, I'm sorry to Mr. Torrance sitting us under there, but I just think it's worthwhile, out of justice to the petitioner, because we don't really
identify
have a clear answer to that, so we should at least get an answer to that. And
Mr. Stewart.
I would also like to support Mr. Ewing, convener, because I do think there is an opportunity here, and I would like to hear from the management steering group as to where we are. So I would propose to keep the petition open for us to take some more deliberation.
Thank you.
Mr. Chowdhury, do you wish to close the petition or would you like to explore your interest in camper vans a little further?
I think we should explore more.
Are you content that we proceed at least to that stage, Mr. Torrens?
Yes.
Thank you. That concludes item one. We move to item two, which is the consideration of new petitions. And as always, for those who might be tuning in, because we are considering a petition for the first time, we do invite the Parliament's independent research body, SPICE, to offer its reflections on the petition, and we also invite the Scottish Government to give their initial thoughts on the petition. It doesn't in any way determine the outcome of the petition, but it does mean we proceed on an informed basis. And the first of those petitions is petition number 2016 to raise awareness of thrombosis in Scotland, lodged by Gordon McPherson, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to raise awareness of risk factors, signs and symptoms of thrombosis. And Jackie Bailey has stayed with us for this petition as well, having an interest in it. And according to NHS Inform, deep vein thrombosis, DVT as I think many now know it, is a blood clot that develops within the deep vein in the body, usually in the leg. Blood clots that develop in a vein are also known as venous thrombosis. DVT usually occurs in a deep leg vein, a larger vein that runs through the muscles of the calf and the thigh. It can also occur in the pelvis or abdomen. It can cause pain and swelling in the leg and may lead to complications such as pulmonary embolism. Now, the Scottish Government's response to the petition explains that it carefully prioritises the issues to which funding and staff resource are allocated, with the close input of clinicians. Since it has already provided updated material to clinicians and revised the guidance available to the general public and NHS Inform on thrombosis, the Scottish Government does not consider that this is the right time for a major public awareness campaign. It does, however, commit to running a package of activity on the Scottish Government's health social media account on thrombosis awareness later this year. The petitioner's submission raises a response to the Scottish Government's cited statistics on thrombosis, highlighting that the higher number provided in his petition was taken from a ministerial answer to a question lodged by Jackie Bailey, MSP. And therefore, before I ask members if they wish to comment, especially in the light of the Scottish Government's quite clear direction, if there's anything Jackie Bailey would like to say to the committee.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I'm very grateful for the opportunity to speak today. Gordon McPherson is in fact a world ambassador for World Thrombosis Day. He's been campaigning on this issue for 20 years, and I feel I've known him for each and every one of those years. He is persistent, and rightly so, because he is asking the Scottish Government to raise greater awareness of deaths in Scotland that can be attributed to thrombosis, as you've outlined, but to show the risk factors and signs and symptoms to look for in order to reduce mortality and morbidity. Now, the petitioner lost his own daughter, Katie, who was an occupational therapist in 2003 when doctors at two hospitals failed to spot a blood clot in her leg and she was sent home with painkillers. Mr. McPherson feels that if medical staff had been more aware of the risk factors plus the signs and symptoms, then Katie may not have died from untreated thrombosis. Now, the Scottish Government have not run an awareness campaign on this since 2011, and Mr. McPherson feels that they're not treating this as seriously as is required. And as a result of a lack of awareness by both the public and medical professionals, he is concerned that there will be increased cases of thrombosis. He is keen that the government does more than they are already doing. And he's not looking for something that's hugely expensive. It is practical stuff that he is suggesting. So one example I would share with you is he's talked about blood clot alert cards. Now, these are available in Ireland. They inform patients of the risk, signs and need to get medical attention fast in the event of a clot. Now, that strikes me as something that the Scottish Government could do quite effectively without too much cost. He's raised issues like this with the Scottish Government over the last 20 years, and they've been particularly unhelpful in trying to progress this. But the reason I think he's brought back this new petition, which makes this more significant, is new research by the British Medical Journal shows that there's an increased risk of DVT up to 3 months after a COVID-19 infection, pulmonary embolism up to 6 months after, and a bleeding event up to 2 months after. So the circumstances around thrombosis have clearly changed since the government's last awareness campaign in 2011, when COVID-19 was not the health risk that it is obviously now. So in light of this, I would be most grateful if the committee would consider that it would be wise for the government to take another look at public and medical professional awareness of thrombosis so that more lives, like Katie's, are not lost. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Jackie Bailey. And that actually was, I think, quite helpful and compelling evidence. Colleagues, do we have any suggestions? Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I think I'm grateful to Jackie Bailey for shedding light on this new information that there is now linkages with COVID and the thrombosis and other linkages which suggest a need for further consideration of what interventions, preventative interventions, for example, might be appropriate in identifying those particular cases where there's a risk predisposition. So I'm grateful for that point. I thought that point was well worth putting to the Minister. What I had picked up from just reading through the papers, and I'm new to this, and I don't know the petitioner, but obviously, the loss of his daughter is a crushing blow. So he has been through the mill, and one death is one too many. So when I refer to the numbers, just bear that in mind. But there is a clear conflict between the figures that he has provided, which I think it's 11,400 deaths per annum in Scotland, and then the figures the Scottish Government have replied with, which is 380 deaths from blood clots. A total of 1,925 where blood clots were mentioned, 380 direct and 1,545 as a contributing cause. So he then has replied to that response in turn, saying that it's not the first time the Scottish Government has quoted one set of figures when there are other figures which reflect the case I put forward. And I would be interested to learn more about that and tease out why the figures he refers to are roughly 10 times greater than the figures the Scottish Government says. But whether or not it's 1,000 or 10,000, I mean, I think it's such a serious thing. The consequences can, in serious cases, be fatal. So, you know, I do think that whether it's a public information campaign or other specific actions taken on the basis of proper clinical considerations about preventative action, it's something that we just need more information on at this point from the Scottish Government. Whether we want to do that by letter or by evidence, I haven't got to.
Can I ask Jackie Bailey, if she doesn't mind, the petitioner feels that his figures came from a ministerial response you received. Have you yourself been able to establish or understand why there might be a discrepancy in the two sets of figures?
No, but he's accurate in saying that the first set of figures that he's quoting were provided to me, I think, in a parliamentary question, and I'm happy to provide that to the committee if they don't have sight of it already.
Right. I think then, colleagues, it would certainly be useful to write to the Scottish Government, first of all, seeking an explanation for the discrepancy in the figures. Secondly, I think if we were able to draw attention to this report, which has suggested there could be a link with COVID, and therefore also, I think, just refer back to the petitioner's long-standing association with this issue and the fact that this is all about prevention and that circumstances have changed and that it could be in the light of all of this that it is necessary to do a little bit more than was being previously suggested. Any other suggestions? Are colleagues content with that suggestion? Yeah. Any other suggestions? David Turner?
I just wonder if we write to the Scottish Government, because I know they've got this health awareness messaging and social media later this year, and the facts that's been brought up to us about COVID. I wonder if that could be put into a social media campaign that's going ahead.
Yeah. OK, so we will keep it open on that basis. Thank you very much. And that brings us then to our final petition this morning, which is petition number 2018, to recognise the value of swimming pools and provide financial relief to help keep pools open, lodged by Helen Plank on behalf of Scottish Swimming. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to help keep our swimming pools and leisure centres open by providing financial investment for pools. The petitioner notes the important role swimming can play for the physical and mental well-being of people of all ages, highlighting that pre-COVID, swimming was one of Scotland's highest participation sports. As noted in the papers, a report in November of last year by Community Leisure UK found that 95% of Scotland's leisure facilities are at risk of closure, with swimming pools facing an increasing risk of closure due to the cost of energy required to operate these facilities, subject of our members' debate, I believe, in the Chamber last week. Members may also be aware that increasing financial pressures have recently led to the closure of three public swimming pools in West Lothian, as well as Bucksburn Swimming Pool in Aberdeen. In response to the petition, the Scottish Government states that it has repeatedly called on the UK Government to use all the powers at its disposal to tackle the cost of living crisis and to provide appropriate energy bill relief to leisure facilities. The Scottish Government response goes on to acknowledge the financial package provided by the UK Government to support swimming pools in England, noting that in deciding how to allocate the resulting consequentials, it will consider what support can be provided to the sport and leisure sector in Scotland. And this too, I think, was the subject and content of the debate that I believe I heard last week. The Scottish Government also states that it is working with Sports Scotland to examine the facilities estate in Scotland. Now, we have also received a submission from the petitioner which highlights the estimated social value, some £55 million, swimming contributes to society and notes the role swimming pools play in helping to keep people active, particularly women, people with disabilities and older people. Members will also note from our papers that we've received a submission from our colleague Tess White, MSP, former member of this committee, who is unable to join the meeting today, but wanted to express her support for the petition and highlight concerns about the closure of Bucksburn Swimming Pool in her region. Do members have any comments or suggestions for further action? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think this is a very important and, as you identified, has already been raised a number of times within the Parliament and debates of that nature. So I think it is important that we keep this going, and I think we should write to the Minister of Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport to seek an update on how the Scottish Government intends to allocate the consequentials resulting from the UK Government's funding of swimming pools in England, because that was discussed quite at length in some of the debates you've had, and details of the considerations that the support will provide to ensure the sport and leisure sector within Scotland, and also to write to Sports Scotland to seek further information on the support it is providing to Scottish Swimming in delivering the Scottish Swimming Facilities project. These, as I say, would once again give us an indication as to where we are with this whole process, and these would be the actions I would propose, Convener.
Mr. Chowdhury?
Just to add, I did write to our minister to meet regarding the West Lothian swimming pool closures, and at that time she didn't have time for us to meet. So I would like to keep it open and ask questions. What is Scottish Government doing to support swimming pools?
I mean, I think quite specifically we could ask the Scottish Government to confirm what consequentials have been received. They have given a commitment in the Chamber in response to the debate that they are giving thought to this and deciding how to allocate the resulting consequentials and what support can be provided to sport and leisure sector in Scotland. I think we should ask them not just for an update on that, but when they expect to be able to conclude any deliberations that they have on that, and to make clear and public what, how, if at all, those consequentials are going to be allocated. So I think, given the debate last week, we could be quite specific in regard to all of that. OK, I think we're content to keep the petition open and proceed on that basis. That brings us to the end of the formal part of this morning's proceedings, and therefore we now move into private session.